Am I the meanest?
Sure enough.
Am I the prettiest?
Sure enough.
Am I the baddest mofo low down around this town?
Sure enough.
But who am I?
Sure enough.
Who am I?
Sure enough.
I can't hear you.
Sure enough.
Can you dig it,
sucker?
Can you dig it, suckers? How you doing, fight fans? EJ Boxing Live here with some of the best channels here on YouTube. We're going to talk that boxing stuff. Tuesday night predictions. Man, it's going to be great, man. Tony Thompson. Yeah, it's going to be Tony Thompson begin fighting. We've got loads of fight. Antino Margarito, J-Rock. Man, loads of good fights coming up, man. Lucas Brown, Chagaev. Hey, boy, it's a packed weekend from Friday all the way to Saturday. So, without no further ado, my host, one of the best channels here on YouTube, we've got Scorsese from The Boxing Voice. How you doing, Scorsese?
Man, I'm good. Ready to talk some boxing, bro. All
right, man. We're going to get into it, man. We're going to get straight into it. So, first off, we're going to go straight into Saturday, March the 5th. In Washington, D.C., we got Luis Ortiz versus Tony Thompson. And the heavyweight division, this is for the interim, eliminator to fight Tyson Fury. 12 rounds for the WBA. Yeah, I could say interim or eliminator to fight Tyson Fury. Scorsese, who you got, bro?
Hey, I think they changed that. As far as like the WBA said they not sanctioning the fight. That's recent news. It's like within a few hours they done that. So I'm not sure if this is like the tournament that, because I know the one opponent dropped out and he didn't want to fight Luis Ortiz. They couldn't reach a deal. So Tony Thompson brought in late.
Yeah, that was correct.
Yeah, so that's kind of difficult for, you know, for us to see the direction the WBA gonna go in after this. But prediction wise, if Luis Ortiz is this monster we really think he is, and I did watch his last fight against Jennings probably a week ago, if he this monster we think he is, he should get this stoppage here. He should get this stoppage. He should be more look like the prime version of Klitschko and get stoppages versus his opponent. Tony Thompson's no bum, but he's taking a fight on short notice once again. He's a workmanlike fighter. That's the same kind of fighter that Luis Ortiz just fought in Brian Jennings, a workmanlike opponent, but he's bigger than Jennings. But he's still not a guy that's gonna keep the distance and jab, but he's gonna be in there fighting. And Luis Ortiz should be able to catch him with more uppercuts, more good body shots, and change the fight. Thompson's stamina might be better than Ortiz, and that might play a factor down the stretch. But initially, I got to say Ortiz by knockout. By stoppage. By stoppage.
Yeah. Okay. What round did you go? Any round in particular round?
I'm going to say 7, 8-ish. I'm going to say, let's go 8. 8-round TKO for Luis Ortiz.
Okay, cool, man. Well, let me give you breakdown some stats before I give my prediction. So Tony Thompson, he's 44 years of age. He's had 40 wins with 27 knockouts. He's got 6 losses. 2 of the losses have been by knockout. He's got notable losses against Malik Scott. I think that was a close fight. It was close in that. It was a unanimous decision for Malik Scott. He beat Orlando Solis. That was a good win. He beat him actually twice. He lost to Carlos Takam by a unanimous decision. He lost to Kubit Priyo. That was a good fight. But listen, he knocked that David Price twice in England. And we watched that, and that was surprising. No one actually gave him a chance of winning that fight. And obviously, the Vladimir Klitschko fights, where I think he got stopped in both of them fights. And that's both the stoppages on his 6 losses, the two losses on his 6 losses. And so we go to Luis Ortiz's record. Luis Ortiz is 36 years old, so he's considerably younger. He's got 24 wins with 21 knockouts. No losses, no draws. Boy, so he's definitely going to be the favourite coming into this fight. And he's coming off a good stoppage over Brian Jennings, which is a good notable win for him. Also, he's got two no contests, which is they haven't showed up on his box rec. One against Latif Coyote
and over some drug swing. But since then, he's gone on. He's got three straight in the win. Like I said, with Brian Jemmins, who's the biggest name on his resume. And most experts believe that he will go in to stop. He'll go in to stop Tony Thompson. But me personally, boy, I think it's going to be a good fight. Luis Ortiz better mind out about Tony Thompson can hit. He can hit a bit, but he's out of shape and that. He shouldn't go that many rounds. Luis Ortiz, I agree with T, should be a knockout, probably round five or six. But listen to this. I have Tony Thompson number here. I haven't even before. I'm going to give him a call. This is just out of chance, by the way, fight fans. So if he picks up, we're lucky. If he doesn't, then, you know, it is what it is. So I'm going to give him a call here on Skype, and hopefully he might pick up. But if he doesn't, then, boy. Yeah, what's up, RKO Khan? Good man, he gave me the same big up to me. All right, let me keep Tony Thompson up. Probably in training, like school's easy thinking, so we'll find out.
Connection messaging system. From a
touch tone
telephone, you may dial.
Oh, okay, so obviously, never mind. Well, I guess he couldn't get through to him. Okay, maybe number change, or maybe he's in training, so never happened. But my prediction is, if we knock out, it would have been good if we could have got have a conversation, but it never to not to be. All right, so we're going to move on. Next fight on the undercard of in Washington, D.C., HBO, by the way. This is a HBO card, by the way, which is good for Tony Thompson to be back on HBO. It might be his last hurrah as well, definitely. We've got Jessie Vargas versus Sadam Ali. This is a 12-round fight for the WBO Welterweight Championship. Scorsese, how do you see it?
Hey, look, it's probably good he didn't pick up. We got two people that predicting he's gonna get knocked out trying to talk.
He's cool like that. He's cool like that, you know. I'm cool like that.
Hey, but I'm rooting for him, you know. If he can pull out the upset, that is nothing.
You know what, by the way, he's from Washington as well, so he's fighting his hometown.
It's nothing to it. If he can pull out the upset, best of luck to him, man, you know. But for the undercard predictions, Sadam Ali, Jesse Vargas, it's a fight I'm looking forward to that not many fans have acted like they're looking forward to. Like, it's a step up fight for Ali, and it's like I think it's his next fight since that Bradley close knockdown he almost scored over Bradley for Jesse Vargas. So it's a line in the sand for Jesse Vargas. Either you're going to cross that line or you're going to stay behind, and Sadam Ali's going to cross that line because Vargas hasn't actually crossed that line yet. People thought he's going to be a star. Hasn't happened. It just hasn't happened. From being around Mayweather, it still hasn't happened. Nothing developed for him. And he's still a guy that you can't put your finger on. You know, he can get outworked in a fight. He can start fast. He can look long in the ring. But something just don't translate. But I'm the same way with Sadam Ali. I see a guy that every time I see him fight, I see Keith Thurman versus Leonard Bundle, and he's Keith Thurman in that fight. He's always circling the ring, never standing his ground. He never giving no work in the pocket. And there's two guys I'm just not confident to pick on. But if I wanted to see one advance, and I'm going to pick off me wanting to see Sadam Ali advance more than Jesse Vargas, because I think he brings more dynamics to the welterweight division as Jesse Vargas. I don't think he does as much. He probably better suited at 140, to be honest with you. So I'm hoping Sadam Ali gets a stoppage in this fight. Like, we didn't think he was going to stop Abrego, but he did. So I'm hoping he gets the stoppage here and say, hey, I did something Tim Bradley couldn't do at the welterweight division. So I'm going to say, I'm going to go with knockout. He's going to knock him out and let's go eight again. Knockout and eight.
All right, man. There you go, that's Scorsese's pick. So I'm gonna do some stats and then give you guys some more detail. So Sadam Ali, he's got 22 wins with 13 knockouts, 13 KOs. He's 5'9". He's from Brooklyn, New York. Yeah, young, hungry guy, man. Yeah, he's 27 years of age. And to be honest with you, this is his biggest step up. I haven't got Jeremy Bryan, who beat Isaac. He beat him on split decision. But other than that, there's no real names in him. And this is his first big step up. This is the thing with fight with him. Either he could get over the hump or he can't. Now, on the other side, we have Jesse Vargas with 26 wins with 9 knockouts. So he doesn't really hit that hard. But he's 26 years of age. So he's younger than Sadam Ali. But he's fought names. He's got Antonio Marco on his record. And also he's been a WBA 140 champion. He's got He's got that guy. Is it Kyrie? The one mid. Who's the one Brona beat? What's his name? I can't pronounce that guy's name.
Marco Antonio DeMarco.
No, not Marco Antonio. But the one, you know, Brona won the beat the belt. Brona beat the guy to beat the belt. The guy at 140 for the.
Khabib,
whatever.
Khabib, Agbal. Shit.
There you go. There you go.
I've heard it.
Yeah. But listen to this, yeah. Like, Jessie Vargas is proven, though. He's got Wally Omotuso, was a really good one. I actually thought Omotuso won that fight, but he's fought some names. Wally Omotuso was a very hard fight. He got unanimous decision against him. Khabib Adeverbi, he's got him by unanimous decision. He's got Antonio Marco. These are all, Khabib's a former champion. Wally Omotuso is always a fringe. He's always trying it. And Antonio Marco, DeMarco was a former champion, world champion. And Tim Bradley, to me, it was a one-sided fight to me. Even though Jessie Vargas protested, I felt the fight wasn't that close. Apart from the he stunned him in the last round, not in the last round. Other than that, there wasn't enough happening. But he's been against much higher of a competition. And I'll be honest with you, Sadam Ali hasn't really got no names on his resume. Everyone's expecting Sadam Ali to win harder, but he hasn't stepped up. This is his step up. I'm going to go with Jessie Vargas, actually. I'm going to go with Jessie Vargas to win by unanimous decision and claim the WBA vacant belt. So me and Scorsese have picked both of them. But you've picked Sadam Ali by knockout. I've got Jessie Vargas by unanimous decision.
That's the smart pick. I just kind of feel like Sadam Ali will bring more to that division because this is for the WBO title, like the real deal WBO title. And I don't think Jessie Vargas will bring anything to that title. He would basically get Jessie Vargas might bring Manny Pacquiao out of retirement just to pick up another strap, you know, because it would be like some people feel Wilder is fooled at heavyweight or Billy Joe is fooled at middleweight. That's how people will probably look at Jessie Vargas. You'll see some Heyman fighters trying to do business with top rank. But I think Sadam Ali brings a different dimension where people say, he get in there and box a little bit. But I don't think as much with Jessie Vargas.
That's our predictions. We'll see if it works out. In the chat, by the way, you guys, if you're in the chat listening to this, yeah, you can put your picks. We've got Rascal 222. He's got Sadam Ali, has skills, yeah. Both Sadam Ali and Spence are starting to step up in competition. Yeah, I agree. Definitely. Sadam Ali definitely needs to step up in the competition. This is a good test and for the vacant WBO belt. But you guys in the chat, leave your predictions of who you feel will win, man. Like, just leave your guys. As we're going the list out, just say who you think will win and why. All right, so we're going back into... So my prediction... No, sorry, not my prediction. We're going back to the next fight. So the next fight is J-Rock Williams. That's Julian Williams versus Marcel Matohu. I think he's let me see where this guy's from. He's from France, isn't it? Yeah, he's from France, bro. Okay, so that Marcel Matu, whatever his name, Matudo, he's got one loss on his record against some guy I don't even know. But other than that, his record is 16 wins with 5 knockouts. And so I ain't got no notable name. So he's from France, actually. And J-Rock Williams has got 21 wins with 13 knockouts. He's 5'11". He's 25 years old. How old is that Marcel guy? How old is he? He's 29 years old. And he's 5'8". So they're kind of like around the same height, whatever. And to be honest with you, J-Rock, notable win to me was Joey Hernandez. That was a very good win. And most of these wins have been by knockout, by the way. He's got one no contest, actually. And he's got one draw. Other than that, I think I favour J-Rock Williams to win this fight. That's the way I see it. How do you see it, Scorsese?
You mentioned the Hernandez win, and he went in there. I think it was a 10-rounder. He went 10 every round with him, and then Trout took the Hernandez fight. That's who J-Rock.
Oh, sorry, Joe Hernandez went unanimous decision. You're right. It was a unanimous decision.
Yeah, that was like one of the only ones as of late that he went the rounds, and then Trout went in there. And he just broke Hernandez down, made him quit basically. Yeah. And Trout told him that's how you stop a guy, that's how you do it. And I think J-Rock is an up and coming guy that I want him to do well, but it's like I've heard some interviews, and I just don't. Sometimes I don't like the way he speaks. He says he's a mandatory, like he's not gonna negotiate, like he won't go anywhere to win his title. He said he won't go to Texas to fight a Charlo if he's the mandatory, and that. And those are the type of things you don't really want to hear. He's saying he didn't want to fight Vinus Minerosian based on some pricing out or some. Not a lot of details there, but okay, if you don't do that, find somebody else, I guess. But this opponent he bringing up, I know nothing about. I don't, you know, if anybody does, I'm pretty sure they like the dude's cousin or something. So more than likely, he gets a stoppage or a decision. He's gonna win the fight unless he just becomes a victim to a huge upset. But he's a prospect, and people want him to do well. I think he's gonna let some people down. Even if he does do well, he's not. I don't know, man. I don't like the attitude sometimes.
Yeah, man, I will agree with you, man.
No fighter though, damn good fighter. Don't get me wrong. Very fast hands, a strong ass jab, good footwork. You know, from Philly, they tough. You know, I really believe in him. It's just that he says some things, and as a boxing fan, they kind of like, oh, you're not gonna give me, you know, give the fans what they want. You know. It kind of rubbed me the wrong way. That's it. Like, cause let me say why. Cause I don't want people to feel like I'm being, just hard on them for no reason. I feel like Heyman has made some of these guys entitled because he pays them more than they're worth. Because he was trying to, you know, he was trying to build his brand, his Heyman brand, saying we make money, we pay good money, and these guys have become entitled due to him overpaying them, like. Al Heyman should have the right to take all these guys to court and get his money back, you know, and say, give me my entitlement back, too, because it's me, not you. And it's just simple as that. So that's why some of them, when they talk like they the big man, I'll be like, man, just go fight and let your skills do it, and then we can all be good. But Heyman made them privileges. It's not Heyman's fault. He was just trying to do what's good for boxing. But that's why I don't like certain things he says.
Cool, man. So that's 12 rounds in the junior middleweight division. So see if J-Rock will come through. The fight basically going to be in Bethlehem. It's going to be in Philadelphia anyway, so the Showtime. And on the undercard of that main event, we have Tony Harrison versus Fernando Guerrero. Now, this is a 10 rounds in the middleweight division. And to be honest with you, I remember Tony Harrison in his last fight against, what's his name again, against Willie Nelson. That was a wicked fight, bro. That was a good fight. And you know what? He was undefeated before that fight. But since then, he's won another fight. So he beats a guy called Cecil. This other guy, he's beat a fight since then. It was a nice decision. But it was a big learning curve to lose against Willie Nelson. That was an up and down fight. But I think in this Fernando Guerrero fight, this is going to be a war. Tony Harrison's record is 22 wins with 18 KOs. Obviously, one loss to Willie Nelson. And now with that loss, he got the KO. Fernando Guerrero record is 28 wins with 20 knockouts. He got all three losses are lost by knockouts. So this is a crossroads kind of fight. Even at young ages, he's 29 years of age is Fernando Guerrero. Tony Harrison is 25 years of age. And to be honest with you, Fernando Guerrero's he's got losses. Oh, he got losses against David Lemieux. He's got, and these are KOs, man. He lost against Peter Quillian. He's been KO'd. You got Grady Brewer Craig KO'd him as well. So you've got a kind of favorite at the minute, Tony Harrison. But I don't know. In fact, it's quite even in terms of, you know, how these guys are probably, every time they've been asked to step up, they've kind of failed. So it's a kind of crossroads fight. I think I'll go slightly with Tony Harrison's a bit fresher. For now, I think so, because the losses from Fernando Guerrero, three losses, three knockouts, shows me that, you know, maybe a bit punch with. So I'm going to go with Tony Harrison by knockout. In the fight is scheduled. What's this? It doesn't really say what this fight is scheduled for.
Ten rounder.
Yeah, it's a 10-rounder. So I'm going to go with Tony Harrison knockout in the 10th round. What's your take, Scorsese?
Tony Harrison, like that dude, man. And you're right, that Willie Nelson fight showed he got a lot of heart to even take that fight, because Willie, you know, you might not say Willie's like a great, but you know he's not gonna quit fighting. You know he's gonna put his punches together. Tall, he's taller than everybody at 154. Hell, the dude got heavyweight height, light heavyweight height, if you want to say anything. And Tony Harrison got in the ring with him. He was giving him a schooling. He was landing hard body punches. something just went out, stamina, something, you know, something went wrong, and he took a punch while tired. The man turned around to the ropes. It looked like he said a prayer, and the referee stopped the fight. It looked like it broke his heart, but gave him some experience. For some reason, I like Tony Harrison. I think he's the type of dude that will go out there and fight anybody because he believes in himself. He talk a lot, too, but he believe it. Like we said with J-Rock, he didn't fight Minor Erosion. Tony Harrison made no indications that Willie Nelson couldn't get in the ring with him. Like, the fight happened. He lost the fight that he was winning. But you're right. Fernando Guerrero, always fun to watch. I think last time I seen him was on Bounce TV. I'm going to go with Harrison by decision here. I don't think Fernando's going to come lay down. And I don't think this fight has been short notice either, because Harrison's always training. He's always on Instagram and Twitter showing his training videos. That's another thing I like. So it's not short notice. I don't think Fernando's coming to lay his head on the ropes and say, take the victory. But Harrison going to show he got a little more class in there. He's going to win a unanimous decision. And I think it's bigger things to come from there. And, you know, it might be a blessing that he took that loss earlier, because it's like, hey, I lost before. What's the worst that could happen? But then that could work against you as well, because you could get comfortable with losing. But something about me says he's not comfortable with losing. I think it's going to work in his favor.
Absolutely, man. So, well, I agree with you, man. I agree with you. But it's definitely a fight that's going to be exciting. And so on the undercard of that fight.
That's Showtime, right? That's Showtime?
That's Showtime, yeah. That's going to be
good. I think they got the maybe the better undercard. What was the first fight we said?
J-Rock Williams versus
J-Rock. And what was the undercard to that one?
No, that was it. That's the main event, and Tony Harrison is the undercard. The one before is the HBO one. That's Luis Ortiz, Tony Thompson, and Jesse Vargas and Sadam.
I think somebody's on before Tony Harrison on that fight.
No, they got Antonio Douglas is fighting some other guy.
Yeah, that Antoine Douglas. That's what it was. Antoine Douglas. He's a good prospect over here too at middleweight. That's the one.
I can't pronounce the guy's name. The other guy's name, I can't. He's a 10 rounder as well. I don't know too much about Antonio Douglas.
He's just a good prospect. You know, he hasn't taken a step up. This was supposed to be a step up. Who dropped out of the fight? He was supposed to fight the guy, the bad knee, Solomon. He was supposed to fight Sam Solomon.
That's right. See, that would have been Showtime there, Sam Solomon. That would have been a probably better fight, man. Sam Solomon's probably lucky, though, because, you know, his knees after the Jermaine Taylor, I'm surprised he's even still fighting, actually. But,
you know, I wanted to see it because the guy that Triple G is about to fight, Paul Solomon, and the dude had no quit. He had the ugliest style ever, like always. And he made him struggle so bad. And I wanted to see if Antoine Douglas was going to just, like, go in there and take him apart and prove, like, I'm better than some of these other prospects. Because that's what a lot of people think they are. If you remember what's that fight that Jacobs versus Quillen? They had Wilder and Douglas. They interviewed Wilder and Douglas at the same time. And that was like Showtime trying to bring him past prospect level right there. And they tried to do it with his next fight as well. But like we said, the guy dropped out. So I'm looking to see more of him. You know, basically, if you watch his highlights, it'll be like watching his whole career, because he's not fought nobody that could stop him. I mean, he's good, though.
Yeah, well, definitely. We'll see. We'll find if you find out. So we're going over there to Russia. And we have Ruslan Chagaev versus Lucas Brown. This should be a very good fight. This is another fight, as like Tony Thompson and Luis Ortiz. It's a tournament to see who's going to be facing Tyson Fury. Lucas Brown's record is, he's from Australia. He's from New South Wales, sorry. And in Australia. His record is 23 wins with 20 knockouts. He's 36 years of age. That's getting on a bit. And he's got victories over James Toney, Richard Towers, which is pretty good. And, these are the most notable names in his record. And this is a big step up. Ruslan Chagaev, his record is 24 wins, 21 by knockout. He's got two losses. One of the losses, he's been KO'd, and he's got one draw. and he's got Frezes Coendo, won by a majority decision. And who else has he got on his resume? He beat Alexander Povetkin, beat him by unanimous decision, and Vladimir Klitschko has also beat him. I think he beat him by RTM. I don't know what that is, man. He beat him anyway, so he's lost to him as well. So I think he's stoppage, actually. I think it's probably technical decision. Yeah, it was technical decision. Yeah, I think that's his only stoppage. So I've been saying that. I hope Lucas wins. He's 37 years of age. I hope Lucas Brown wins, actually. But it's in Russia. It's Hugh Jagger. But I hope Lucas can stop him and win, because Lucas is, you know, he's been dying for this opportunity to get. So I'm going to go with Lucas Brown by stoppage. Obviously, it's 12 round. I'm going to go Lucas Lick stoppage, 9th round stoppage. Go ahead, Scorsese.
You know, I always hear my boy The Wire talking about Lucas Brown. I always mean to go watch this dude. And I never really get around to it. And I did get around to it. I just don't remember him. I don't remember much of him. But The Wire talks about this man like he is the next coming of greatness of the heavyweight division. And I'm hoping he can pull it off. And I know he's like this new name for some people, but he's old as hell. Like, both of these guys are in mid-30s, but you've heard of Shigaya forever. You know what I mean? Like, so which one really going to bring the most to the division? I think Lucas can, because he can punch. He's supposedly this huge puncher, and I've seen him really get some good shots in. I'm not sure, man. I'm not sure here, but I'm going for, you know, I know they call him the Big Daddy. I want him to win the fight so I can see more fights, and I gotta just watch more of them. But I'm gonna go for him because I got some people that I respect as far as about YTBC. The Philly's a good fighter, so I want to see him in with the people that they don't like Wilder. Like, some people say this guy would, like The Wire, for instance, says he's a bum rush Wilder. And I like to see that, since he feels that way.
Oh, that's a bit hard. Well, I don't know, man. Lucas has done what he's finding. Like, he's at the Commonwealth belt for the longest. By the way, I've actually got Lucas's number. I'm going to try and bring him. He's probably, I don't know if this number will work, actually, because it's been a fair time, actually. Let me see if I record him. Let's see what his opinion. Because actually, Lucas, he's on my Facebook thing. He's a good guy in that. If he's available, I think he might talk to us. I don't know if you remember me, though, because I haven't talked to him for quite a long while. Let me see if he picked up. Hopefully he does. It'd be good to get his take on obviously the fight as well. Let me see if it's ringing. Is it going to ring? I guess not, man. It's showing his thing.
I'm gonna pull up some footage of him here so I can see what
it's not getting through. All right, it's not getting through, so never mind. Hey, man, then we tried. So I got late stoppage. How do you see the fight?
Well, like I said, I'm hoping he can get the stoppage and progress on in the division. I don't know how much a guy has left, but every time it's been an opponent noteworthy, he hasn't got the job done. But you know, it is in, you say Russia, right? That is in Russia, ain't it?
It's in Russia, yeah.
Well, he traveling. So, you know, you never know right there, man. I hate to hear a robbery, but I feel like for some reason, every time I hear Russia, I'm going to hear that, or Germany, either one. I just put them together and just link them, you know. But I think he could get it done, though. I think he's going to win. He could knock the guy out, hopefully. He is the bigger man in the ring again. He's a big ass dude, man. That's one thing I know about him, and I ain't even seen much of him. He's a big ass dude.
So you got Lucas by stoppage, yeah?
Yeah, I'm gonna go with Lucas stoppage.
Well, you got a round?
Oh, nah, not a round. I haven't studied enough to see it, but it was a fight I was gonna go ahead and stream, but I know he got that power beyond belief. He's hitting people and they getting out of that.
Okay, fair enough then. All right, so we're moving on down to where we got. We're moving on down to Mexico City, and we've got the debut, should I say, the return of Antonio Margarito versus Jorge Pais Jr. This is 10th round in the welterweight division. Hey, man, and Antonio Margarito is back, man. A lot of dispute people probably think he should be fighting again, but he is what he is, and finally gets Jorge Pais Jr. I'll let T take on this against Jorge Paez Jr.? Go ahead. Sorry, for Scorsese.
I'm glad he's back too, man. He's getting a lot of bullying on that eye picture. Like, he's all over Twitter with one eye open and one closed, and it's hard to even remember unless you watched the fight and got a great memory, which eye Pacquiao messed up, because they both look flicked. You know, one is closed and one is like just open, man. It's ignorant. But I'm glad he's back. I'm hoping that, you know, maybe since Cotto is like in the last days, maybe Cotto says, hey, I'll fight Margarito again, and nobody would complain. Maybe Marquez said, hey, we both old as hell. Did you say at the welterweight division? Because I've been wondering, like, where this man going to fight at?
Yeah, they're fighting at welterweight.
I can't believe this dude is 6 foot plus and can still make 147 pounds. That's nuts.
He's 5'11", says the box trip, bro. That's tall, still. Quite tall.
Well, yeah. He right next to 6 foot. He was in there with Paul Williams. He didn't look no bit of a midget toward Paul Williams. Mm-hmm. But, I think it's amazing for him to be able to make 147 still. I'm kind of looking ahead, hoping he wins this fight. But I don't know what he's going to look like, man. How is his style supposed to translate? He got hit a lot already. His eyes messed up as is. He throws a lot of punches, stayed out the ring. We don't know the shape he's in. How can he still maintain that style that he was at this age? It's not like he's going to become Floyd Mayweather with the defense or Rigo or somebody who can get hit or see punches coming and not get hit by them. And if they do get hit, they take things off the punches because they turn with it. He's not going to become that. But hopefully he can win the fight, and I hope he get in there with one of these older fighters on the way out, like Marquez. I'm hoping that can happen.
So how you see again Paez? You got him winning, or what you say?
Yeah, he got.
Hey, the last time he fought was in 2011, you know, and that was
hard to call,
Miguel, man. It was the one he got technical stuff.
Hard to call. I know he in there with an opponent he's supposed to be, but. Shit, man. You know, you take that much punishment as he do, and you've been out the ring, you might find out that it ain't as easy as you think. So, the Paez Jr., what do I remember him from?
Vivian Harris outpointed him. It's Jorge Paez Jr. You know his father, Jorge Paez Sr., the clown, isn't it? You know, he fought featherweight.
He was, Paez Jr. was recently on PBC, right or wrong?
Let me see. Was he on PBC? His last fight was in Mexico, and that wasn't recently in PBC. Jose Benavides. Is that the fight you're talking about?
Benavides. No, that was True TV. It was True TV. That's where I remember him from.
That's where I remember him from.
Yeah, and
he got KO'd in that fight, right?
Yeah, that's why.
I couldn't put it together. He was fighting the top ranked fighter, Jose Benavides, after Benavides robbed Herrera. And they actually demoted Benavides to True TV and put Herrera on HBO because it was a robbery. Then Benavides like fucked him up in front of his people and everything. Like his dad was there. You just mentioned his dad. He got embarrassed in front of all of them. Mm-hmm. But I think that's the plan again, Marco. But he's going to take punishment, though, man. His style just screams, hit me, you know? It ain't got no way. But he's going to win the fight. I'm just going to say he's not going to knock dude out. He's going to win the fight. If he wins the fight by knockout, it'll be a body shot because I don't think the dude will be in shape or really trying to win the fight. I don't know, man. It's crazy. It's crazy.
Well, look, man. Look, well, Jorge Paez Jr. gets Benavidez been stopped, and you know he's won them a shot by majority decision against Daniel, whatever his name, another guy, and he's lost recently, so he's lost a bit. Maybe his confidence is not all there, but I think Margarito might be fresh and rejuvenized, and he's probably been training longer. I'm gonna go with Margarito. Margarito still can hit like he can. He'll wear down Jorge Paez, and I can see him stopping him probably in the round eight, maybe. I can see him stopping him round eight. I could probably see that. You know, he's been he still hits hard in the welterweight division. So, you're right, you know, after that long from 2011 to be off that long, I can see him stopping in 2011. So that's the thing, that's the fight I see. There's some other fights which are happening over in the UK. We've got Sammy Eggington versus Bradley Skeete, which should be interesting. There's 12 rounds in the welterweight division. That should be an interesting fight over here. I don't know if you American guys know it, or guys in England know about them. That should be an interesting fight to see how that one. Sam Eggington, he's pretty good. Brian Skeete, I think Bradley Skeete should probably might win that fight, but I'm not too sure. I won't put my money on it. And another fight, what I didn't mention, which happened on Friday, we have what's his name again? Shinsuke Yamanaka versus Liborio Solis. This is for the, it's a 12 round in the bantamweight division for the Dobe for Yamanaka's WBC bantamweight championship. Should be interesting, but I'll probably pick Yamanaka in that fight. Other things here that I don't think me and Scorsese mentioned, the weekend fights. I don't think me and Scorsese, we actually mentioned, talked about the weekend fights, bro. Crawford versus Lundy. I don't think I've actually got your take on that. Go ahead, bro.
Crawford, too much of a beast, too much of a heat-seeking missile. He's seeking destroy. Like, Lundy looked nice for parts of the round. I heard people call him a front runner. I don't want to go that far, because if he looked that nice at 135, he might have a shot to be, you know, I don't think he'd beat Bartholomew, but he could pick up some belts down there. Crawford just way too much on the front foot for him. You know, way too much of a jab, punching in his face, poking a jab in his face. He let Crawford be way too comfortable. He's trying to switch up and match Crawford. And, like, so I think it's the same round he switched up, he was on the ground. Crawford is something else, man. I mean, a lot of people picking on him because he's fighting these smaller fighters. And, okay, fine. But if he knocks out Postal, I don't want to see Crawford versus Pacquiao. I don't want to see that fight. I want to see him get two belts at 140 pounds, because I do rate Postal as a good fighter. I think Postal right now is just as good as win as Pacquiao. Not historically, you know, like when somebody look at the resume, they're not going to know Postal is. But for us watching, we recognize the skill in Postal. We recognize skill in Crawford. And that's a fight that I need to see. Like, Tyrion got to do that. Shouldn't be no ducking, no dodging. Make that happen. Crawford just something else, man. Like, he's an animal. He, but when he go up in weight, he got to start a little faster. Defensively, he has to start a little faster. If you want to fill the opponent out, he need to do so without taking so many punches. Because, you know, up in, as far as you go up in weight, that power change, and, you know, I might get a glove in it. You never know. Even if it's not a knockout, you got to stop taking so many punches early.
I can tell you what, he's the most complete fighter, one of the most complete fighters in the game. He's very exciting. Hank Lundy came out in that fight like a volcano. He came after Terence Crawford like no man's ever came after him, and it was a surprise to me that I thought Hank Lundy, you know, was really putting it on. When he changed stances, then it was like he just opened up on him and took him out. And you got to understand, Hank Lundy's never been stopped. He's been stopped before, but that's only the second time he's only been stopped in his career. And that was, to me, I was very impressed by that. But I was impressed by Hank Lundy, where Hank Lundy brought the fight. But, man, Crawford has turned it up. I like the way Crawford moves back and makes guys at the end of his punches, where he gets leverage. And I mind the hands at the way, where he can keep guys at the end, where he can get his leverage and throw his punches. And it was a masterful performance. Now, talking about one of our other YouTubers, I'm going to get your take on this, Shady Slim. Shady Slim has put it out there that he thinks, yeah, that Terence Crawford could beat Mayweather. And this is his reasoning why. He said, Shady Slim says, the reason why he could beat it because Mayweather's old and Crawford is too young and quick and Mayweather's been cherry-picking. What's your take on Mayweather versus Terence Crawford right now if they were to fight?
Let me take it back to the Lundy fight, because we saw Lundy come out and prove that he didn't know how to pace himself. Like, if he know how to pace himself, ain't no telling what we would have saw, because he had the right distance to lead off on Crawford. He had everything working, but he didn't pace himself. Crawford, I don't know if the experience is that'd be Mayweather right now, because Mayweather settled for one shot. you know, he'll settle for one shot and trust everything else that he can do after that. Hank felt he had to get it done early. It's a difference, man. Like, I don't even want to go there yet. I don't want to go there. I won't call for the buildings. Danny Garcia said something I respected so much. He said they asked him about fighting Mayweather when he was in the process of unifying the 140-pound division, even more than he had already done. He said, man, I'm not worried about Mayweather. I want my own legacy for they can say, am I just as good as him? If I ever make it to 147, then it is what it is. You know what I mean? So if Crawford, if they ask him about that and Crawford come out and say, man, I want this 140-pound division sold up because it's a good division, like Broner, all them. If you get up to 147, go at your own pace. Learn at your own pace, and then we might be having a conversation for who's a better fighter. But at this moment, unless Mayweather is all the way slowed down, and we know it's not all the way there, I think he can pot shot his way to victory. Crawford's proven easy to hit too much, and Mayweather's not Lundy and not finding counters and changing it. He's getting under these counters. He's doing what he got to do to win fights. Yeah, I don't care if he do it by one punch. He's doing it. So I don't think Crawford beats him right now.
Okay, cool. And then the other fight we have Leo Santa Cruz versus what's his name again? Kiko Martinez. For me, that was exactly what I thought he was gonna get beat up. Martinez, but great, brave guy, actually brave. He actually done well to go to the fifth round, but he went the way I thought he was gonna go. Give us your take on that fight.
Leo Santa Cruz, I know he got a lot of flack for the fight, but he became one of my favorite fighters that night. Like, I haven't liked him very much. I've even said some of his fights are boring, because it is boring when you see a guy in there that has no chance, no size, and that just throwing punches back to the guy that is a star. It is kind of boring. But I respect Kiko Martinez, and I felt like moving up in weight would do good things for him. And four rounds, it did look like it did do some good things for him. He looked big in there. He looked like the tank compared to the to the willow tree. But he looked like the tank, and he was landing his good shots. But Leo Santa Cruz, he shortened his shots up so pretty on the inside, man. He mess around, get the jab in your face off if you think he can't box. His feet still aren't great, but it's no place in the ring he don't look uncomfortable in, because all he got to do is start punching like he normally do. And, you know, did he duck Rigo all that? I will never argue. He sure did. That's one person but he can still do good things outside of Rigo. I like the dude, man. It's crazy. You know, a good performance, a hell of a performance. Blood on his face. He did take some punches. That was to be expected. He's always going to take punches, but his game plan is to outpunch you. People wanted him to outbox. I seen others' channels say, why didn't he just outbox him? Nah, that's not what he's going to do. But his power at 126 may be better than it was at 122. Hopefully Gary Russell next, or Selby, one of those.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. All right, last news. So you saw the press conference with Adrian Broner a couple of days ago. Adrian Broner, Ashley Fearfay. What's your take out of that? And give your overall opinion. Who do you think is going to win the fight?
I didn't see the press. I didn't watch it. I didn't get to watch the press conference, but I did see the quotes where he was saying "fuck the whole team" over there.
Mm-hmm.
Ashley Theopain, he took some good fighters to the wire. The style ain't, you know, it's a little nasty style he got over there. Adrian Broner, you seen when he got in with a nasty style like Parley, that he was having trouble. Maybe the same thing happens, man. Maybe, you know, Adrian Broner, you never know what you get. Is he gonna show up in shape? Is he gonna show up with a nice haircut and not in shape? You know what I mean? That might be the Adrian Broner you get. But if it's the best of Adrian Broner, he's going to return at 140 and get a unanimous decision. He's not getting any more stoppages, I don't think.
Yeah, I don't see that way, man.
No, I take that back. Adrian Broner just got to stop it. So I need to take that back. I can't sit up there and say that. If he's in shape, he's getting a stoppage.
We got Gus over here from the thing. Gus. You can call in, or you can just press this. Let me give this guy.
Was the guy that, is that the guy that him and Nash had the argument?
Yeah. I'm calling him right now. I've him. Gus, how you doing, man?
Yeah, good. Thank you, EJ. How you doing, my man?
Yeah, I'm cool. You can't jump into the hangar. It'd be easier than you can. Much easier. Who of you has pressed the link, or you have you got a YouTube channel?
I'm listening live via YouTube, but.
Yeah, I just gave you a link. See that Google link here? If you press that link, you can actually come into the hangout.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, try that. Yeah, you can jump in. Me and have a chat about up-and-coming fights and you and Nez's little conversation.
Okay. Yeah?
So that's Gus, man. Yeah, so we've got the first time Gus coming over. Let's see how he goes, isn't it? It's goes easy. Well, it should be interesting then. It's goes easy.
I guess he talked about the fight.
And this is the... There we go. Who's that? Umar just jumped in. How you doing, Umar? Umar?
Yep.
How you doing, my friend? Here with Scores AZ, bro.
Yep.
So what's going on, Umar, man? We just took covering the weekend fights. Your guy, Sadam Ali, from your ends, from New York. What's your take against him, against Jesse Vargas?
Well, the young god, Sadam Ali, Bismillah, Rahman, Rahim, Alhamdulillah, Khran, or me, right up the road from Williamsburg, Brooklyn, he's going to get it done, man. Allah bless him. He's going to get it done. That's all I got to say. He's destined. He's destined for greatness, and it's going to happen. It's going to happen, no doubt about it.
Okay, cool, man. And we've got Luis Ortiz versus Tony Thompson. How you see that?
Man, Tony Thompson's probably like 46, 47 years old, man. I like Tony. I mean, Tony gave us interviews. Tony's a cool cat. But I don't see how he can hang with Ortiz at this point. I mean, if he can, more power to him. I just don't see it happen.
Wow, man. So that's a nice short and crisp. What else we got in there? You got any other fights, Umar, on your mind of the weekend? We've got quite a lot of fights in the weekend, you know, Umar. We got Tony Harrison versus Fernando Guerrero.
Yeah. Didn't Tony Harrison just get knocked out his last fight?
Yeah, against Willie Nelson. That was a good fight, though, eh?
Yeah, it was a solid fight, but he was talking all that shit. He got stopped. But I think he should be able to. If he can't beat Fernando Guerrero, he might as well retire and sell cars, because Fernando Guerrero done been knocked out by everybody.
See, absolutely. We got one of your favorite fighters actually fighting on Friday, Orlando Cruz. Yeah, first. Raymond Cashner. This is junior featherweight, junior lightweight division, 10-rounder. How do you think your boy is gonna do, Umar?
Man, you know, good and damn well I don't like that rainbow thong wearing faggot, man. I hope Orlando Cruz get hit by a car on the way to the fight. I don't give a fuck who he's fighting. I hope he loses.
Oh my god! Do you think him and Manny Pacquiao is gonna have conversations? Probably, you know, he wants to take Manny Pacquiao out for dinner and stuff like that, so we can understand him a bit more, innit?
Man, I hope they have that dinner in the Philippines so Manny Pacquiao could put him in a ditch somewhere, man. I'm not worried about no Orlando Cruz. I don't even know why you brought him up, because you knew you was going to get me into a mind state you didn't want me to be in. So let's move away from Orlando Cruz.
All right, cool. Let me call Gus. I think Gus is having problems coming into the group. Hammer. Let me call Gus. Yo, Gus.
Yes.
Yeah, don't worry about it, man. That would get me. Yeah, so what's going on, Gus, man? It's good to have you over to EJ Boxing Live Show Prediction. This is Prediction Tuesday, so we're talking about the fights that are coming this weekend. You got any take, or do you want me to go through who's fighting?
Yeah. No, I'm familiar with the schedule. The fights I've been looking at. The one in Russia is the interesting fight. Mm. Now, we know the whole sort of the belt situation with the WBA is very, very confusing, but Ruslan Shagaev is the WBA regular champion, Tyson Fury is the WBA super world champion, and Luis Ortiz is the WBA interim champion. But the bizarre thing is that the interim champion is interim to the regular champion and not the super world champion, which is the definitive belt. Now, we know they've got a tournament in the WBA, I think there's 6 or 7 different opponents, and eventually they're going to try and phase out this this regular championship and just have the Super World Championship, and they may have the interim. The WBA hasn't announced that, but pending sort of injuries and whatever else. But with the Ruslan Shadaev, the interesting thing is that he's a very, very good fighter and has been. It was only a vintage Vladimir Klitschko that stopped him, because he's a short heavyweight. I think he's under 6 feet, possibly 5'10", 5'11".
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But with him is, the situation with him is his illness. Now, I think he's been suffering with hepatitis for quite a long time, and hence it's restricted his performances. And I believe there is some quarantine procedures with him actually fighting overseas. But I don't think overseas countries have allowed him to come to the States. So the question is, how is his health currently? Injuries and sort of illnesses, if he didn't have those issues, he would have fought probably a lot more regularly. So my only advice to Big Daddy Brown is keep the fight at long distance, because you don't want this guy breathing over you, because you might be coming back in a body bag.
That's a good point. All right, question from the UK. We've got fighting in Birmingham on Sky. Sam Eggington versus Bradley Skeete. Obviously, with my American panel here, I'm not too sure they know about him, but give us your take on Bradley Skeete. Obviously, we know Bradley Skeete is with Frank Warren.
You know better than that, Errol. You know I know both those fighters. Stop.
Okay, oh, cool, Umar. All right, so I'll give you a take in a bit on that one. So give your take, Gus, on Sam Eggington versus Bradley Skeete. Eddie Hearn versus Frank Warren.
Yeah, that's very, very good to see. I like this sort of rivalry between the two factions, and hopefully we'll get that with the Flanagan-Crawler fight, if it ever happens. But Sag Eggington is an interesting guy. You know, he's been making a lot of plaudits with his recent performances on Sky. And he seems to be very much the guy on the march. But there's a lot of people with the Frank Warren camps that thinks that Bradley is a rough diamond. And I think they're actually predicting that he'd be able to knock out Sam very, very early. But I think Sam's a very underrated boxer. I think he can trade toe-to-toe when he has to. He's improved his ring generalship a little bit. His movements were a little bit cumbersome during the early sort of stages, because, let's face it, he's got no amateur pedigree at all. I mean, he's coming off prize fighters and there was those other tournaments. So 50-50, but I'd probably go for Sam Eggington, I think.
All right, cool, man. All right, cool. Last thing before, also there's another show, probably if you're around, Michael Pound for Pound Boxing Show. They have it show every Thursday. It's like late at night. But if you're around, I'll give you a link to that one, if you're ready. Last one, you and Nez. What an up and down one that was, yeah, on the PVC. Now,
yeah.
obviously, where you work, obviously, like, you gave your take on you don't think the PVC worked. Nez gave his take on that. For the people listening, can you elaborate on what happened and give us your take on that? I'm sure the people in the panel will probably have some words for you, but give us your take. Go ahead.
What it is, EJ, is that, you know, Nessa subsequently, basically, I wouldn't say he's conceded, but he's saying that, look, you did make some valid points, and maybe I was a little bit sort of critical, and hence is going to allow me to sort of, you know, my only intention in this one was just to look at the business model. It's not because I'm a hater or whatever else. Now, you know, all these pre-misconceptions, you know, I mean, I'm a boxing fan and have been for over 35 years, passionate fan. So it was more curiosity in looking at the business model and looking at, you know, the performances to see if it was a credible business model. So, you know, I did a little bit of sort of investigation, you know, some of the work I do in my sort of personal life, I have access to, you know, very good set of systems which allow me to do analysis on companies and look at their accounts, and hence I did some research into the PBC just to see what their gate receipts were. And I was curious about these lawsuits which were impending, so there was a lot of negativity. So I was trying to think, well, Is there any substance in this top rank and sort of golden boy lawsuits, or are they bitter because 70% of their fighters have obviously defected to the PBC. Yeah. So I had a look at it, and I'm still having a look at it. And the problem is that a lot of people don't understand what it is. It's venture capitalism. Basically, you've got fund managers, mutual funds company, and investment banks in the US who basically allow individuals to buy companies and businesses, etc. So they've obviously invested into the PBC series. So it's not Al Heyman's money, essentially. It's these venture capitalists. So they've invested a lot of money, and hence Al was negotiating directly with these networks, securing the purse bits and the fighters with the venture capitalist funds. And he's effectively spent up to $960 million for the next 2 years on fighters and venues, from what I can see on the accounts. And looking at the gate receipts, there's effectively no profit being made at all, and there's significant losses from what I can see in every one of the showcase fights over the last sort of 13 months. So it sort of begs the question, you know, is it really going to be sustainable for the long run? The current model, I can't see it. Something would definitely have to change. And effectively, these venture capitalists, they won't even make break even. I've done a little projection, and I can see it'll be at least 6 years before they even break even. So are they realistically going to keep pumping a billion dollars every year? No, they won't.
That's a good point. But obviously, we know that the PVC model, and over here in the UK with ITV, Al Heyman's, and obviously he's got three Al Heyman fighters. He's got James DeGale. He has who else he got over here? He's got the Welsh baby.
Frampton.
Yeah, Kiel Frampton. So he's got UK fighters ready to go if they have a 10-fight down. So if they come over in the UK, maybe they can do some of them. How do you, right? Because I'm not.
Yo, can I jump in on the fucking Bradley Ski fight, bro?
Yeah, in a minute, Umar. How do you think they could change their profits for them to make a profit? Or maybe that's his intentions, is just basically to get boxing out there. How do you see it for them to change it around?
It's very difficult. How it would work is that at the moment, sort of viewership in the States, peak times on some of the shows have been around 5 million views, which is pretty good. Now the networks will probably buy the productions if they can get around 6-7 million. So it's depending on viewerships and it's depending on ratings. If it's a lucrative proposition, then now Heyman can actually sell the shows back to the networks instead of him paying like Showtime $30 million a year to actually show it. Mm. So that's ideally what he's trying to do. And the only way he's going to get that is by better matchups, quality fighters, and a lot of that we're not seeing at the moment. We've got too many. The problem with boxing is that we've got too many belts, too many fighters who don't want to fight each other, and we've got corrupt sanctioning bodies. We need to strip all of these belts and go back to the Ring Magazine belt as it was in the early 1900s, because this is just now getting ridiculous. Everybody can just fight for a title now, and it's not done by no subjective ranking system. It's done by these conventions that the WBC, WBA, IBF, and WBO hold, where they charge to actually speak. And basically, they take deals and backhanders off these promoters to get their fighters on the rankings. Now, that's how titles are decided, and that's how rankings are decided. It's not based on any strategic, credible system where if a fighter beats a fighter, he obtains a ranking point. I've had a look at them, and they just don't make any sense at all.
Yeah, that's a good point, man. You make a good point about that. Fair point about that, man. Well, at least you had your take on that. Gus, I'm gonna leave you though, but Gus, take this shit.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah, we like I said, there's Powerbound Boxing Show happening this Thursday, so I'll send you a link if you're around for that one. And if I have a show in the weekend, actually, we've got a post fight. Be around us for that one. But Gus, appreciate you coming over. You've got to leave any where people social media can catch you.
At the moment, I'm sort of anonymous at the moment. I'm better that way because I'm making so many so-called controversial comments. I better keep it anonymous.
All right, then. Fair enough, Gus. Hey, we appreciate you coming over and we'll talk to you soon, mate. Take care.
Okay.
All right. Umar, Bradley Skeete, and Sam Eggington. Go ahead, my man.
All right, before I go into Bradley Skeete, I got to comment on what he was saying. And I don't know why you would come to a British person to tell you how an American business, as far as the TV, will work. It makes no sense. And you know that I've been saying this for the longest fucking time. The problem with the PBC, even though I had a lot of fucking pushback from British people, not you, Arrow, because you know how shit works. EJ Boxing, you know how shit works over here better than most British people. A lot of British people say, oh, boxing should be able to compete with NFL. It should be able to compete with college football. No, it can't. You want PBC to fucking work? Start it after the NFL season and the college football season ends. From right now to the end of the summer, that's when they should fucking push all their fights. The problem is they're putting all their fights on Saturdays in the afternoon, the night, against college football, not going to work. You're putting them on Sunday against NFL, not going to work. People are watching those games, period. Period. I don't want to hear nothing from nobody from no other fucking country because they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. Okay? College football games get 20 million plus viewers no matter what. So you can't compete with that. So what you need to do is wait till college football and all that. It's a lull when it's just spring training baseball, which is not real baseball, and basketball before the playoffs. There's a nice little gap there. That's when you need to put the fights in between there, and that's where you get the ratings because there's a lull there.
Listen,
anybody that can't see, that's a fucking idiot.
Now, listen to this, yeah? Boxing, football, basketball, and all things there. Back in the days, Umar, this is in the 80s, they all used to be around the same time. And it gave the viewer a chance to change. Yeah, obviously the market is for football because they've been...
The market has changed. Yeah, and you know the market has changed.
Let me finish what I'm saying because you bring a good point, right? But what I'm trying to say to you is that that is the prime time slot for boxing in terms of if you're going to catch any sort of audience. So I wouldn't say they're competing, but they're giving the audience an alternative. And that's the main time thing. But you're absolutely right. Football, basketball, and a number of other sports, obviously, they're in season, the majority of football. But people is giving a fan watching alternative views. So it's just given, maybe, I give an example, you give a big point. Maybe they've got off season where they're going to get all the attention. But again, it's going to be main time they get all the attention. But again, when the football and them not come, most fans are going to go back to that. So I don't think it's to do with the viewership in terms of that. I think it's to do with what Gus said. I think it's to do with the matchups, Umar. I think if you really have...
I don't think it has anything to do with the matchups because look at what the MLS does, right? The MLS is smart, right? The MLS, even though America hates soccer, right? But the MLS is finding their fucking place. They don't start their season until after football ends. Mm-hmm. Football ends, MLS starts. So they can pick up the random viewers as far as... And plus the regular people that like soccer. That's what they do. You think it would be smart for them to go against the NFL or college football? No.
I wouldn't compare football that Americans don't really care about compared to boxing. Americans love boxing. It's just that boxing has no heavyweights now. They don't take Wilder and I'm a heavyweight, but I still absolutely agree with you that they absolutely agree with you in terms of if they have different slots, they can get more ratings. I agree with you. But the thing is, Americans and boxing, they go together as one. It's just that, like in amateurs is not that good. And obviously, in the pro ranks, America's not leading the world in boxing. You know, your heavyweight champion is over here in the UK. You know what I'm trying to say? So, and even that, even over here, Umar, right? Tyson Fury's the heavyweight champion of the world. He's not on the mainstream TV channels either. So
it's disgusting. I see how that is. They got fucking, they're hyping up Anthony Joshua more than they are the heavyweight champion of the world, which is disgusting.
No, not really, because he was on TV and he's Olympic gold medalist. And that everyone saw that who's watched TV. Most people, but some people don't know who Anthony Joshua is. But I think boxing over in the world has suffered hardship in terms of what Gus pointed out as well with the sanctioning bodies and the corruption in boxing. So I take a bit of everything.
My opinion, right? From February to August, we should be boxing PBC.
not even boxing, PBC's window. Put on shows from February when football ends to August, right before football begins in September. Put on shows. Then you'll pick up way more viewers because there's no football, the other sports are dense, and you got a chance to just pick up people who want to watch sports, casual people.
Yeah, I agree. Pick up ratings. Now you've got a good point, man. It's a good point. Yeah.
You know good and damn well because you watch college football. You love Vince Young.
Yeah,
you love
all this shit. Boxing, but you see, the thing is, if college, when college on, I'd watch both of them. I remember, like, I'd be honest
with you. No, I know you do and I do. I do the same thing. I watch both. But a lot of people don't. The majority of people just say, hey, if there's a boxing match on and there's my football game on, I'm watching a football game. Fuck the boxing. And that's what most people do.
Yeah. Hey, listen, man. I don't know if the football fan is the boxing fan. If the boxing fan is a baseball fan or the baseball fan is a basketball fan, I can't guarantee that the guys I talk to who watch basketball watch boxing. It doesn't. It's just that I just grew up in that. Some of the UFC fan watch boxing fan. I'm a guy who watch UFC and boxing. So you can have collab over and watch. Because I watch UFC if there's good fights. And I watch boxing, depending on if there's good fights as well. So, you know, it'll go both ways, depending on what kind of things you like. But you bring a good point in terms of off-season and trying to catch the market there and build up. I think, you know, you're absolutely right. Because there was a lull for 3 weeks, yeah? There was a lull in the boxing, and the PBC never capitalized it in January. They could have capitalized it. Last year they did with Deontay Wilder. But, again, this is new, Umar. It's a new system. They're still working at the kinks. I think Gus is talking about, obviously, in terms of the matchups, he's got a good point, but I think a lot of Mexican, there's a lot of Latino fighters, and obviously, you know, Latino kind of carry the market in terms of the States. So, but I'll tell you what, the PBC would work over in the UK. I think the PBC would work over here. I think it would work easy. I think it would work really
well. It might work well. I'm not talking about England. I can't speak to the market in England. That would be better for you, but I'm speaking to the market in America.
Mm-hmm.
When I hear people from other countries telling me that college football shouldn't be competing. And I heard so many videos from dumbass people from England, and I'm not even mentioning names, but dumbass people from England are trying to tell Americans that college football shouldn't compete with boxing. No, dumbass. The market has changed. College football is God. NFL is God in this country. Nothing's going to compete with that. Nothing. And that's the point I always try to make to people. Nothing can compete with that. So what you should do is avoid it. You know what I'm saying? Like, just avoid it. Like, duck college football. Move into the offseason of college and NFL football and put your shows right then and there. Bounce back. Kill them with the shows and you'll get ratings.
Cool, man. No problem. All right, give us your take on Bradley Skeete versus Sam Eggington.
Well, I think Bradley Skeete should win that fight, man, because I seen Sam Eggington fight that one fight. He fought against that. What's that guy? Fucking something Coyle? And the guy had, like, fucking three fights, and he lost that fight to the guy. And at the time, fucking, this guy had, like, 16, 17. No, he had 17. He had 17 fights. Now, he had, like, 15, 16 fights at the time. He lost to a guy with three fucking fights. I think Bradley Skeete should be able to take care of this guy. I mean, he lost to Frankie Gavin in a somewhat close fight, even though they gave that unanimous decision. But I think he should be able to handle Sam Eggington. If he can't handle Eggington, then I think he's got a lot more trouble to go in the future.
Yeah, cool. And we've got Kyle Yagafai versus Dixon Flores. How you see that fight now?
I don't know. EJ, I don't know who either one of those guys are.
Yeah, you guys know what I'm saying, bro. But you know what? I was actually surprised. That's why I wasn't even trying to be rude. I didn't know you knew them two, but I'm glad you did, though, because, you know, it's good you talked about them. So, all right, so let's talk about a fight. I talked to you about Tony Thompson, whatever, and you've done, I think the last one is Ruslan Chagovai versus Lucas Brown. I don't know if you've
I didn't get to talk about that.
Yeah.
I remember yesterday you were telling me that they were, or maybe not yesterday, maybe the day before, but yeah, I remember you telling me that.
It was yesterday I told you.
You're telling me that they were calling Chagai of the Iron White Tyson or some shit?
Yeah, his nickname is the White Tyson, yeah.
Yeah, White Tyson. I mean, he is a midget. He does hit hard, but I don't know about all that. But I, like I was saying to you yesterday, bro, when I seen Lucas Brown's last fight, he was struggling with that black dude with, like, 16 losses. Mm. Like,
I don't know, man. I never heard of that black dude. That black dude was slipping punches and looking good for the first six rounds. See, I mean, he eventually got knocked out. But, I mean, the guy already had 16 losses, got knocked out 12 times before that. So, I mean, he was supposed to get knocked out. But for six, seven rounds, he's over here slipping your punches and making you look silly. So, I got to think Chagayev should be able to do something with you. So, I'm going to pick Chagayev.
Yeah, that's true. Well, but so you got Chagayev winning that fight against Lucas Brown, right?
Yeah, I do. I mean, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but I got to go with Chagayev.
What you got? Your nice decision, knockout? How do you see it?
I got a decision because I got a decision.
Cool, man. Jorge Paez Jr. goes against Antonio Margarito, return of Antonio Margarito in Mexico. How do you see that fight going?
See, that's a hard fight. I've seen Jorge Paez fight a couple times. He is what he is. He's a solid fighter for what he is. And but the thing about Antonio Margarito is I haven't seen Margarito fight. I'm going to keep it real. The last time I seen Margarito fight a fight was when he got knocked out by Shane Mosley. That's the last time I seen him fight. Or was the Manny Pacquiao fight after that?
Okay. Jorge Paez, you're talking about, or?
No, Margarito. Was the Manny Pacquiao fight after that?
Yeah, Manny Pacquiao took his eye out and shit, bro.
That's the last time I seen
Cotto was the last one you bashed him up.
All right, well, then Cotto. I seen all three of those fights. So one of those was the last time I seen him fight. So I don't know how much Margarito's left. I don't know what he's coming with. But if Margarito's coming with, say, 75 to 80% of what Margarito was, I think he should handle Paez Jr., but I really don't know, but I just go with Margarito just because I don't know enough about Paez.
Vivian Harris outpointed him clearly. He can hit pretty hard as Paez. Vivian Harris, he's only 5'7", and Margarito is 5'11". And you know,
he's tall and he's long. Margarito should be able to handle it. If he can't, then he might as well retire.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, breaking news, Umar. And give your first take. You give your first take on this. Shannon Briggs versus David Haye possible for May the 31st at the O2 Arena in London. Let's go, champ.
I don't even care who wins. I think the shit just gonna be entertaining as hell because Shannon gonna be talking that greasiness, that greasy griminess. But Shannon from Brownsville, man. I'm rooting for Shannon. I can't root for David Haye over Shannon, even though David Haye probably flatline him. I'm rooting for the old man with the veins popping out of his forehead. I'm rooting for Shannon.
Let me tell you something, bro. Shannon can bag me, bro. Shannon the Cannon Briggs can punch. David better fucking move away from him and punches, bro. He can put it on you, so I ain't gonna be surprised, yeah. If he put some serious pressure on Haye, stamina doesn't hold up, but we'll have to find out.
You seen David Haye? Who the fuck would? What was that? What's homeboy's name that knocked David Haye out in the roast, basically?
Carl Thompson, man.
Yeah, he basically gassed in that fight. Mm-hmm. So I mean, but that was a long, long time ago. So I can't really use that against him. But I mean, if Shannon could survive the first four rounds, I think he could give David Haye some trouble down the stretch. But if David Haye catches him early, you know it's gonna be ugly because David Haye hits like a fucking ton, man.
Absolutely, and we've got Nata TV coming. How you doing, Nata?
Hey, what's going on? What's up, man?
Hey, cool, man. At least I got you for the little guys because I don't show Umar, and I definitely Scorsese didn't know about it. We got Yamanaka. What's his name again? Shizuki Yamanaka versus
Liborio Solis. Yeah.
See, Nata knows, bro. So give us your take on that fight. All right.
Thing is, Yamanaka, to be honest, I actually thought he lost his last couple of fights. I mean, I think he's been the kind of a beneficiary, or maybe not his last couple, but two of his last three anyway. I thought Moreno beat him, but, you know, they were fighting in Japan. I think he kind of got one of those tie goes to the hometown fighter type deals. And he actually had the same thing against a fighter from Thailand. Sorry,
yeah, I saw that fight. That was a good fight, bro. I actually done commentary on that one. Nice decision. He won that one. That was a tight fight. Go ahead.
Yeah. No, and the thing is, the Moreno fight was tight too. And really, I thought Moreno beat him, but you know, he managed to get the decision. I think there's a good chance that this may happen again with Solis too, because Solis is a pretty good fighter. He's a dude from Venezuela. And I mean, he's a skilled guy. He only had he has a couple losses from like earlier in his career, but he's improved since then. And yeah. I think he'll be another tough fight for Yamanaka. The thing about Yamanaka is he's fought really high level opposition, like guy, you know, tough guy after tough guy. That's a big part of the reason why he's kind of ranked like in the bottom part of the top 10 pound for pound on certain lists. Like I think the ring has him like number 10.
Yeah,
and I mean it's really just by virtue of the fact that he's been fighting like the best opposition at bantamweight. Even if like personally I don't think he's won all the fights, but I mean just the fact that he's been fighting them has really kind of gotten him there by attrition, really. Solis is another tough fight for his ass though. Like I mean he might not get as lucky this time because I mean he's just as tough as. Well, I don't want to say just as tough as Moreno was, because Moreno was, like, legit. Like, to me, Moreno was, like, probably one of the most skilled guys, regardless of weight.
You know, I did see that Moreno versus Yamanaka fight. I did see that fight.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I know, yeah, I'm not, I know you're familiar with Moreno.
I didn't realize Moreno fought him until now to just brought it up, because I watched the last, like, four fights of Moreno. Moreno has been getting some tough decisions in a lot of his fights lately.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, an undercard fight. Yo, we come up.
Yo, the undercard fight on that fight is good. Like, you're gonna want to catch it on YouTube after it happens, cause Yukimura, that guy is a fucking action fighter, man. He's fighting against Ganagan Lopez. Honestly, I think it's probably gonna go just like his last couple of fights have gone. Like,
yo, how the fuck do you know these guys?
I watch you these guys, but I can't pronounce their names for freaking. But go ahead, Nauta, because
yeah, no, Yukimura, like he honestly, I thought he got a robbery against Pedro Guevara in his last fight, and I mean, but the thing is, he's one of those guys that, you know, he's good, he's a good fighter, but he's flawed, and he's flawed enough so that even a guy that's not on the elite level is gonna give him hell, and I think that's exactly what Lopez is gonna be for him.
Yeah.
All
right, so that guy, I saw that come off. I see him beat.
Because the thing is, Ganagan Lopez, he actually fought Guevara too. They both fought Guevara last year.
Yeah.
Lopez lost the unanimous decision, but it was a close one.
Yeah.
And Kimura won a split decision. And like, really, I thought he should have lost that.
That's
really even matched.
It should be good, isn't it? It should be a good match, actually.
Yeah, yeah. That one especially. That one will probably be like the most action-packed fight of the weekend, because I mean those guys like.
No, to me the hookup.
Just
hook
the styles, the way the styles match up.
No, to me the hookup and do some commentary on that one, bro.
Hook up, for sure.
Do some commentary on that one. But no, to see something like Nota, and this is the thing about everyone who's joined the panel. Everyone has got their specific areas of what they like to talk about. So Nota, we got Umar's favorite fight, Orlando Cruz versus. I don't know this guy's name. What do you know about?
Yo, you better stop, my nigga. You better stop with that. You better stop with that shit.
Umar gonna bleed the flag and shit.
Nah, Umar can't stand him. I'm just being sarcastic.
Honestly though, like, you know, no disrespect to anybody, but the funniest thing, like, honestly, because like it was like a trip, like I never would have expected it. Was I think it was on the Bradley versus Marquez undercard when Orlando Cruz fought Orlando Salido.
Yeah.
And the entire crowd started chanting "Puto, Puto, Puto" like in like the fourth round.
I remember that. That's when Salido fucking dropped him in the corner. He beat him to a submission in the corner.
What's Puto mean? What's that mean?
It means bitch in Spanish.
Okay, cool.
It means bitch.
Yeah. So basically, like, I was watching, I'm like, oh, shit, Salido better run out of there. He's going to get charged with a hate crime after this shit. He's doing to chance like that.
Yo, he deserved that, man. You know why he deserved that beating? Not even because he's a Bati boy. He deserved a beating because he came to the weigh-in in that leopard, I mean, that rainbow-colored thong. That shit really pissed me off.
Did you see the trunks, though?
Yeah,
it was the Puerto Rican flag in the rainbow colors.
Yeah, and I know Puerto Rican. I know that's the first time in history Puerto Ricans won a day on fighter to get knocked the fuck out. I guarantee you.
His opponent, Koasicha, he actually fought. He's fought a couple of good fighters. He fought Lomachenko. His last fight, got knocked out by him. So I mean, really, I'd say these guys are pretty much equal level. He fought Lee Selby also. Lee Selby got a.
So you're going to win about cruising in.
I mean, honestly, I think Koasicha probably is a little too much for him to be real with you.
Yeah,
I think he's probably a little too tough. He's a, you know, he's not, he's like no special effects or anything, but you know, he's a grinder. And
that tells you what Nauta just says, tells you the level, and I just want to move it a little bit to a left. That shows you the level of fighter that Lomachenko's been fighting for his last couple of fights. He's fighting guys that are nowhere near his level.
Oh yeah, man. They've been patty caking him, man. They've been giving him a lot of
this is ridiculous.
Okay. Hey Nauta, so this is the thing I can go with Nauta. So there's a fight in Thailand. Go or Dory. Oh.
Go ahead. Yeah, go Odaira versus Wanhang Manayotin.
Yeah. This is for the people listening, it's a 12-round strawweight division for the WBC. What's his name again? What's his name again? WBC strawweight.
Manayotin.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. Manayotin, he's an interesting character, man. He's 40-0 with 15 knockouts. So I mean, if you want to look at anybody that might be knocking on the door that 50-0, it might be him, because he's averaged like 4 fights a year the last 3 years, even though he's a champion. You know, most champions don't fight that often. But sometimes, like especially these guys from Thailand, they'll fight their next door neighbor, then they'll fight, you know, elite level competition. You know, they fight anybody and everybody.
And his records is, so he's got 40 wins with 15 knockouts. Bro, that guy's been busy, bro. Fuck
yeah.
That
kid, bro. Woo. Yeah, well, and like a lot of fighters from Thailand, you know, he was a Muay Thai practitioner before he like turned over to boxing. And you know, he's just been doing his thing.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's good. He's really good though. Like he's short. He's only like 5'1.5" or 5'2". Mm. But I mean, the thing is, like, he's able to close distance on guys. Like, he's fought guys that are like 5'4", 5'5", and had no problems closing the distance on them.
Let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question. Strawweight, that's 105, right?
Yeah, that's the lightest.
Yeah, it's the lightest.
305,
yeah. The thing is,
Odaira has a height advantage on him because he's 5'3".
Yeah.
But Odaira, I mean, he's a good fighter, though. I mean, so, like, this is a legit opponent for him, really, because Odaira had fought the guy that was the unified strawweight champion. Takayama. He was fighting Takayama evenly, but then Takayama managed to knock him out. He just, you know, hit him with one of those, you know, those wild, random shots, and it was over.
That was a good fight.
One more question now, because you watch all these little guys, and I know whenever I watch little fights, it's usually like a brawl that goes all the rounds, and they're just throwing a million punches. How many times do you see, like, knockouts down there?
Well, and generally, like, there'll be more, like, the volume-type knockouts. There'll be, like, those TKO-type fights, you know, type knockouts. But really, it depends on the fighter. I mean, I'd say it's not to a high degree less than any other weight class. I mean, to be completely real, it really depends on the fighter, but it's just so happened, I think a lot of the best fighters at the lowest weights haven't been big punchers necessarily. Like even Calderon, you know, he only had like 5 knockouts in his whole career, but he was a skillful, you know, technician. But every once in a while, like when you get guys that are like true one shotters, like, you know, like Arroyo was, like, or is, like Valoria was, like Segura was.
Are you talking about Mick Williams Arroyo?
Yeah. Arroyo. I like
Mick Williams Arroyo. He can punch.
Mike Joe Arroyo can punch as well.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, Mick Joe's a bit more technical, though. Like, he's like, for the Arroyos, it's almost like Mick Williams is more like Rafael, and Mick Joe is more like Juan Manuel. You know, he's more of the boxer.
Yeah, that's a good way to describe it.
Yeah, Mick Williams is the guy that wants to fucking knock you the fuck out. Like, he's putting everything on that hook.
Yeah.
I like watching the Arroyo brothers. I like watching them. They're really good.
Nauta, I want to talk to you about a fight. This fight really bothers me. It's that Carlos Quadra. You know what I'm talking about? Was Carlos Quadra, and he won the belt off this Thailand fighter, Saring Saw Ruzran, whatever his name is, yeah?
Yeah.
That dude, he's been campaigning, since then he's lost, yeah? Since then he lost to Carlos Quadra, and he won that fight. I don't know if you've seen, I've done commentary in here, where him and a body shot, and they had a head clash, and he won the belt by basically a technical decision. He's won like 8 in a row, and his last fight, yeah, he fought in Thailand, he hit a guy with a body shot, yeah? Listen to this, right, people? The guy, everything the guy ate up the day before came out on the ring apron. I'm talking about blood, cakes, everything. It all came out of his stomach and it's all over the canvas. It was ridiculous. I'm actually going to do commentary. What do you think about that guy, the Thailand fighter? And when do you think he should be fighting for the belt? I mean, he's had like, what, 11 in a row since losing to Cardra by technical decision. What's your take on that fight? And
Well, supposedly they were supposed to be running it back. I mean, because Rung Vasai just became the, he became the mandatory, I think, last year.
When he
knocked out Jose Zagala. Mm-hmm. But I mean, he's actually a good example of what Ben Umar was just talking about. He's a guy that he'll knock you the fuck out. Like he'll fuck your shit up.
Best body punches ever.
Yeah, he's 38, 4-1 with 35 knockouts. You know, that's like a 90% knockout ratio for wins.
Yeah.
So I mean, he'll mess you up pretty bad. And I mean the fight with him and Quadros was really heating up too before, you know, before that shit got stopped.
Quadros got a body punch, yeah, and he was on the run, bro. Yeah. He was about to get taken out, bro.
Yeah.
And the head clash came in. He's lucky. Yeah. He's about to get took out in Mexico.
Yeah, I mean, I'm hoping they can do that rematch before Quadros possibly gets a fight with Roman Gonzalez, because I know the word was Gonzalez was probably going to be moving up to 115 after Arroyo.
Yeah.
And either fighting somebody like Kono or Quadros. And see, Quadros is with Taken Promotions, and Taken Promotions is who's the main promoter for Gonzalez. You know, they've been outsourcing out to K2 for his American fights. So, I mean, it would be easy to make. You know, they'd be able to keep more of the money in-house. And also,
Roman's still at 112?
Yeah.
So he's got 150 money else. So he ain't going to ever make it up to 122.
Nah, he looks
fat. Honestly, I doubt it because, I mean, yeah, you know, he started at 105. He legit struggled to make 105. 108 was a little bit, you know, it wasn't like necessarily a super struggle, but you know, it's one of those things where he felt more comfortable moving up again. And I mean, I know his goal like was to win titles at two weight classes at the same time. So I don't know if he wanted to do it at 112 and 115 or 115 and 118. But I mean, to be honest, I doubt he would ever see 122. Because I mean, even though he gets a little chubby between fights, like it seems like he loses it real fast. Because he does, you know, like it, and it also it looks like it's more like in his face. Like he has one of those bear faces or whatever. You know,
if he makes it up to 122, then he has to fight Riggin though, and I don't think he's gonna go up there and fuck around with that.
Yeah, honestly, I doubt he would. But if I mean, there's all these people that are trying to say that Regal would be willing to fight him at 118. I don't know if that's just Max Kellerman talking shit, which I'm sure it probably is. But, I mean, either way, I mean, I wouldn't mind seeing it regardless of the weight. Because, I mean, I know Regal...
Riggin don't make 118.
Well, see, that's the main thing, is that a lot of people think that he can just because, you know, he's not the biggest guy at 122. But, honestly, I think it's one of those cases where a lot of fighters, when they don't know, when they've never dehydrated before, the first time they do it probably isn't the best time for them to be doing it. Like, remember Chris Bird when he dropped down the heavyweight?
Yeah.
And then he got fucking
wrecked. Oh, yeah, that was bad. That was bad.
He got fucking wrecked, man. He wasn't a big heavyweight.
You know what's funny? Everybody was saying that about him, and I'll give you another one, when Eddie Chambers dropped down from heavyweight to fucking cruiserweight. They just didn't look right.
Chambers,
everybody was saying, oh, they're small, they could drop down these weights. No, they couldn't drop down to those weights.
Yeah, because, I mean, the thing is dehydrating like anything else, I mean, that's a skill. Like, if you don't know how to do it right, you're going to go in there and you're not going to have anything on you. Like, I mean, De La Hoya versus Pacquiao is a good example, too. You know what I mean?
Like, oh, God, yeah, that fight was bullshit. I don't even like De La Hoya, but put it this way. If you telling me the real De La Hoya when he was in his prime at 147 against Pacquiao, that would have been a different fight.
Oh, man.
It would have been completely different.
Completely different. I think Pacquiao probably would have got put to sleep.
Same with Mosley, too. Because, I mean, Mosley was old and, like, he really didn't belong with that weight either. You know, like, exactly. He was talking all that shit about, like, oh, I can still make 147. Like, yeah, and, like, you can make 147 and, like, you know, for a photo shoot, not to be a healthy world-class boxer. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
I mean, that's like bodybuilders, for instance. You know, they'll dehydrate for those shows or whatever. But the thing is, those people that's probably at their most unhealthy when they're on those shows because
they don't have any energy. They have no energy. They have no fucking strength left in their body. They can pose and take pictures, like you said, but they can't. Yeah. They can't do anything else besides that.
Yeah, basically, like they need to eat immediately, or like, you know, they'll fucking pass out and
I walk around normally like 270 pounds. If I drop down to 200 to look all cut up and whatnot, I already ain't in good shape. But if I drop down to 270 to look crazy cut, I would be like a skeleton. I'd be ready to die.
I'm that biggie tip.
Hey, Nota, I don't think we've got your take on the weekend's fights, Crawford, Lundy.
Well, I'll get to those in a second. Let me mention Briggs and Hay, because I heard you guys talking about that.
Let's go chat.
honestly, I really like Briggs. I'm like Umar. I'm a big fan of Briggs. I think probably because like he's nostalgic for me, because it reminds me of when I was a kid, like when he first came onto the scene. But I mean, honestly, David Hay should really knock him out, because if he doesn't, then I mean, I think that's kind of a that'll be kind of a bad look on Hay. And the thing is, Briggs doesn't really... He never had the greatest stamina, and ever since he's gotten older, it's gotten worse. And then also the fact that he's not really the most defensively sound fighter either. So, I mean, to me, unless Hay gets caught with something stupid, which, I mean, Briggs is prone to do, though, because, I mean, Briggs could knock out a fucking elephant with those shots.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I mean, unless he just does something absolutely stupid, get caught with something dumb, Hay should really win that fight, you know, fairly easily. Because I mean, he's too quick, you know. He's too prime still. I mean, honestly, I think he's probably been one of those guys that's benefited from the time off.
Hey, I think he's been more active than Hay. You know, he might have the conditioning. Briggs has got better conditioning. Yeah. He's more active.
Well, and the thing is, Hay looks like he's put on like legit muscle too. Like he looks like you know, he started, you know, like one of those routines to just you know, build mass and, you know, become just a bigger, stronger guy. You know, probably take punches better in the whole nine. So
Briggs has got tons of experience over David Hay in that division. Tons. You know, he's got tons of, whether he'd be able to do it is another thing, but hey, man, it should be an interesting fight. All right, Nata, go on, give us your take on the weekend's fights, bro.
Alright, well, let's see. I guess I'll start with Ortiz Thompson. Ortiz, I mean, I think he's legit, man. I think he's ready for any of the top guys at heavyweight. I'd probably favor him over everybody there except for Fury. I think Fury, I think he'd be able to be a little too slick for him. And also, like, on the inside, too. I think that's the weird thing is that he's the taller guy, but I think he's actually the better inside fighter than Ortiz. Ortiz needs a little space to get his shots off. And the funny thing, though, is Thompson is kind of that way, too. So I think that'll play right into Ortiz's hands. I think Ortiz probably stops him late, maybe like 7th or 8th round, something like that. Sadam Ali versus Jessie Vargas. I got Ali in that one. Vargas hasn't been consistent enough for me. And, I mean, Sadam Ali fought... Who was that dude that he fought? What was that, like one fight ago?
Jeremy Bryan, isn't it? You talking about Jeremy Bryan?
No. Two fights ago. The Mexican cat. I can't think of his name now. The guy, Francisco Santana, that's what his name was.
I thought you were talking about old boy he knocked out, that had been knocked out many times. I forgot my man's name.
No, I'm talking about Santana. Like, Santana was a legit really good fighter, too, because he beat Eddie Gomez. Like, I didn't think Eddie Gomez was going to lose anytime soon, and that dude beat him. So, yeah, I mean, that said a lot.
Eddie Gomez, and speaking of Eddie Gomez, that's EJ's boy. Eddie Gomez's career has went down the toilet.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened to Eddie, and that's EJ's boy.
Yeah, it was my boy. He just went.
Well, I think it's really just that loss kind of put him on the back burner to a degree, because I think he was getting fast tracked, and I mean he'd been fighting since he was like 17.
Yeah.
And he's still a young guy. He's only 23, so I mean he could probably still recover, but he's a dude that I think was another guy that was trying to drain too much, you know, because he had made 147 since he was 17 or whatever. He's a bigger man now, so he should probably just
tell you what. I'll be completely heartbroken and surprised if Sadam loses the fucking old boy, man. I'll be very surprised.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. I think he's just I think Jesse Vargas at his best could potentially beat Sadam Ali, but the thing is, you don't know if he's gonna be at his best. He's wishy washy. Sometimes he looks really good. Yeah. Other times he doesn't look like anything special.
At skill level, they're probably pretty even, but the thing that separates them is Saddam's feet. Saddam's footwork is so great that I think he should be able to box circles around Jesse Vargas if he fights the proper way.
Yeah, no, that's true. I mean, I favor him. I think he wins a decision. I think it'll probably be like close, unanimous, something like that. But yeah, I think Ali's just a step ahead, just a step above.
Tell you what, when he wins that world title, I'm going to his gym on Monday.
Yeah, man. And then the fight on that's gonna start off that card, I believe, Castellanos versus Escandon. That's gonna be a fun one, man. That's gonna be a lot of fun.
What weight class is that?
It's a featherweight.
Okay, go ahead.
Let me see. Is it for a title or? Well, okay, it's for the WBC interim. Mm. So I guess the winner becomes the Mando for Santa Cruz has the WBC, doesn't he?
Yeah.
So whoever wins will be the Mando. I know Escandon was supposed to fight. Well, I know when Rigo was in talks with possibly signing to Heyman before, they were trying to give him Escandon. You know, when, and then Moises Flores beat Escandon for his 122 title, so that kind of went down the tubes. And then they were going to offer him Flores, and then, you know, Rigo signed to Roc Nation, and that was that. And then Escandon, they were actually going to match him up against Gary Russell Jr., but then Gary Russell pulled out of that fight. I guess they said that he messed up his hand or something. Mm-hmm. He missed out on that. But I thought Escandon would have given him, like, a hell of a run, if not beat him. He's a good fighter. He's really short. He's only, like, 5'2", 5'3", but he's fast, man. He's fast as shit. And he had a fight against the guy Jesus Cuellar. He knocked Cuellar the fuck out. He was hurting quite bad in that fight just because he was way too quick for him. He's only 5'1.5" is what he's listed on BoxRec, so he's a little guy. But he closed the distance fast as hell. He's like almost like a mini Gamboa type dude. And then Castellanos is, he's like a boxer slugger, I guess you might call him. He's technically proficient as a boxer. But he has good ability on the inside and, like, the good ability to kind of swarm you. And he'll, like, take little side steps to the side and, like, you know, and just, you know, hit you with combination after combination, sidestep combination. So, like, he's really good at that. So, honestly, I think that's going to be an action fight. I think that'll probably be the best fight of that card between those two.
Wow, man. Covering that. Antonio Margarito is going against Jorge Pais Jr. What's your take on that, bro?
Well, you know, Pais Jr. is not a joke. I don't know if you guys saw his fight with fights with Chavez Jr. Or not Chavez Jr. with Omar Chavez.
I think I saw one of them, but I saw Pais versus Jr.
Pais Jr. I mean, in spite of the fact that Margarito's gonna have like a big like height and reach advantage on him. Pius Jr. closes the distance real quick, man. He's not an easy guy to beat. But I mean, put it this way, Jose Benavidez knocked him out. Margarito, at least on paper, should be able to stop him, if not beat him clearly. So, I mean, really Margarito should take it, and I think he will. I mean, even against Toro in that last fight, I thought Margarito still had some of the old stuff. You know, I think it just probably took him longer to get warmed up because, you know, he's an older guy. It's become tougher to make the weights and everything for him. And, you know, that's the case, it tends to take you longer to warm up. And also the fact that Cotto had improved also since the first fight. You know, he was...
That's what I would say. If Margarito's Margarito, he should be able to beat Paez.
Yeah.
Like that's something you can think about.
And I'm sure he does. I mean, I doubt he's really depreciated because, I mean, who else has he really, like, had taken damage against since Cotto? I mean, nobody.
But you just screwed me on something. I didn't know that dude Escandon beat Cuellar. I didn't know he beat Cuellar.
Yeah, he knocked him out.
I know Cuellar. Cuellar's a pretty good fighter. I didn't know he beat him.
Yeah, he sparked him. He's one of those guys that, you know, he's almost like, you know, pretty much like the way Pacquiao was at the higher weights, like, he's just short, but he's explosive. And I think the fact that he's able to use the fact that he's so short to his advantage, that's almost like he'll get guys to lean in on him, and then he'll just, you know, just pretty much explode like into like Superman punches basically at him and, you know, hit him.
You gave me a good reason to watch that fight now, because I know who Cuellar is, so, and this guy knocked Cuellar out, so I could watch that fight and enjoy it.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be a good fight. Castellanos isn't a joke either. He had a setback when he got TKO'd by Rene Alvarado a couple years back. But, I mean, other than that, he's been one of those guys that he's got one of those records almost like a Saliba, where he was getting matched tough guy after tough guy after tough guy, and he, it kind of built him into a, you know,
Well, yeah, Salido's one of my favorite fighters to watch. Salido done lost a gang of fights.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you know, I think they're trying to talk about him versus Vargas. I don't know if they actually got that signed yet, but him versus Francisco Vargas was on the, possibly on the horizon.
Oh, I love watching Francisco Vargas. Shout out to Francisco Vargas, man, when he comes out with the bandana wrapped around his face with them fucking gangsta-ass Mexicans.
Yeah,
looking,
man,
like fucking
yeah.
MS-13 and shit. That dude's a beast.
Yeah, he
Francisco
is.
Francisco Vargas is a beast.
Now, the fight with Muro was the shit, man. That was the fight of the year last year, easy.
Yeah, wow. I told you, EJ, last year, because nobody on our panel at the time, I'm not saying they didn't know who he was, but they didn't remember, and I was like, yo, Francisco Vargas is going to be the fight of the night, yo. Trust me. I kept saying that, and he came out, he showed up and showed out. I love Francisco, man. He's a beast.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. The first time, like, I had seen him before this, but, like, the first time he had really made an impression on me, and I think I had named him, like, my prospect of the year for, like, 2014 or something off of this performance, was when he fought against Brandon Bennett, who was Adrian Broner's homeboy.
Yeah, the black dude. Yeah, the black dude that was supposed to be somebody, and fucking Francisco was a no-name. He came in there and put that work on him. I know exactly what fight you're talking about.
Yeah, Broner wrapped him to the ring and everything. Like, you know, and he was favored. Bennett was favored, too.
He was band camp, he was favored, and he was supposed to beat the shit out of him. Francisco was like, nah, homie. And he beat the shit out of him. Yo, I was like, who's this dude? That's what made me recognize him.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that was a breakthrough. That was a breakthrough performance.
Exactly what you're talking about. I think that was on ESPN, wasn't it? Or Showtime Extreme?
Showbox. It was on Showbox, yeah.
Showbox. Yeah. I remember that fight.
But, what do you call it? Vargas, I think, is all wrong for Salido, though. I think, like, Vargas is pretty much like what Salido was when he was younger. And I think that just the way that style matches up, I think Vargas will probably wind up knocking Salido out. Just because, you know, when you have guys that are similar in style like that, I think the punches line up in a way where, like, they wouldn't otherwise. It almost
yeah,
kind of like.
Now, to what gang is Vargas from? He ain't no Norteño. What the fuck gang is he from? He's from somewhere. He from a Southerner gang or something?
If he was, he'd be rocking either the blue or red. He never rocks like a consistent color. So.
Well, I swear, the dudes he's with are gang affiliated because they look like they killed somebody every time before they come in the ring.
Yeah, possibly. It reminds me of I remember one time I was doing a pod with Lex Ruger and stuff in there, and we were talking about one of Zhou Xiaoming's opponents. Somebody was saying that his opponent looked like a dude straight off of MS-13 and shit. Like he was like about to get the pad on his face.
Straight up, yo. That's why I like Francisco Vargas. He's a gangster, man. He comes
that's the thing. Vargas is from Mexico City, though. So I mean, if he was like straight up from a hood gang, it's probably like one of the real ones, you know, like the cartels.
Yeah,
and shit, you know what I mean?
Yeah, cartel.
Like though, and those are those like I mean the Mexican American gangs, like, you know, they ain't got nothing on those cats, man.
Those dudes have like, beef. Those dudes really pretty much have beef.
Yeah, I mean they ain't got nothing on the El Chapo dudes of the world, man. Those guys will rattle up your whole fucking city.
Shit.
they'll fucking blow your mayor's head off just like to prove a point and shit.
Hey, you guys. Hey, anything else you and the guys want to bring up? You guys give me joy. Anything else you guys want to talk about boxing related?
Well, we got J Rock this weekend too.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, we talked about it. Go ahead, J Rock.
I ain't never seen this Marcello Matano guy. I don't know if he's good or not. But I know J-Rock has been ducked by a lot of guys. You know, there's a lot of people that really don't want to be fighting him. I know he's with Heyman, and he's been trying to get fights with the Lars and the Charlos of the world, but for whatever reason, they haven't been happening. So, I mean, I'm just anxious to see him, you know, back in the scene again. You know, I'm sure he wins, because he's a really good fighter. I mean, this dude would have to be something special, I think, to beat J-Rock.
That's what I was saying.
So, I mean, he should take that. Antoine Douglas, I mean, he should win his fight, too. Who else is on the... Oh, Tony Harrison. Tony Harrison. Why does that name sound familiar?
He's the guy that lost to Willie Nelson.
That's what I thought. Yeah, the knockout artist, man. Yeah, I was really enjoying that fight too, man. I thought he was gonna win that fight.
You fighting it? Yeah.
I thought he's fighting Fernando Guerrero. That guy's not that great. He should knock Guerrero out. Fernando Guerrero got knocked out years back against.
By everybody.
Yeah.
I think Fernando Guerrero's been knocked out by everybody.
I think Angulo ran through him in like a round or something like that too, like a few years ago.
Angulo got him. Peter Quillen got him. Who else got him? A couple more guys got him. Like, and Fernando Guerrero at one point from Maryland.
Never mind. You know what? I was thinking of a different Guerrero. Fernando Guerrero, the Dominican cat.
Yeah, the Dominican. Ness's little brother. I always get on Ness. That's Ness's little brother, man. He gets knocked out by everybody.
Yeah, man. That one against... Didn't Lemieux knock him out, too?
Yes, he did. He got knocked out by everybody. Yeah. Every time he steps up, he gets knocked out.
Well, I mean, this should be no different then. Yo, speaking of which, though, I mean, what's going on with Willie Nelson? They need to get him another fight, man. That was a hell of a knockout when he knocked out.
Willie Nelson's EJ's boy. I don't know. That's EJ.
Yeah, that's my boy. I don't know. I haven't seen him. I mean, I've got him on my Skype sometimes. I message him sometimes and that. But I have no idea. But now to let Uma, give your take. Let Uma, you give your take on it before Nauta jumps in. Because now this goes off.
On what? On Julian?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I thought Julian was calling out Austin Trout, if I'm not mistaken, for a while, and Austin Trout didn't want to fight him. Right. And like Nauta said, it seems like a lot of guys have been ducking him. So I think Julian's going to end up knocking this guy out that he's fighting, because I don't know who the guy he's fighting. And if the guy pulls out an Adrian Granados on him, you know what I mean, and just upsets him, fair enough, but I just assume he's going to win, and he's going to win by knockout. So that's just my assumption. I could be wrong, but I'm going to stick with my assumption. I think I'm right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the guy has one loss, and it was by knockout. So, I mean, that was about two years ago. So J-Rock should take him.
Yeah, in the chat, we've got Brother E. He goes, nah, fam, because I live in D.C. I'm be kind of rooting for him, but I can't see it happening. Ortiz is on a different level. I don't even see a Prime Thomas beating Ortiz. It's true though. That's true, man. I don't see a Prime saying, "Yeah, Beats, thanks, Beats." I tell you what, yeah, like the Ortiz fight. Tony Thompson's fighting in his hometown, and like I said to you, like he is hard. Ortiz better bring his game. But if Ortiz just keeps what he's doing, he should be able to stop Tony Thompson. But it should be a good fight. Tony Thompson's gonna bring. I actually tried to ring him actually, but his phone's off because we had an interview back in the days. About a year ago as well. It was a good interview as well, but should be a good fight. Go ahead, Nauta. Any other fights you missed out?
Hold on a second. Let me take a look at the schedule again.
I was checking the schedule. I know I have my own schedule as well. I got the Ring Magazine schedule right in front of me as well. Like you,
yeah, but I'm looking at the ESPN fight. Well, there's Chagaya versus
Robertson Castillo. You know Robertson thing who beat Ronnie thingy. You know what I'm talking about?
Chagaya versus Lucas Brown.
Go do that.
I mean, Chagaev should win because Lucas Brown, I've seen him in the past. He's a pretty sloppy looking guy, but I mean, he's racked up a bunch of wins lately, so I don't know if he's improved a bit. I mean, honestly, I was never a fan of Chagaev. I remember he was another one of those guys that was going to be like, oh, he's going to give Vladimir Klitschko a run for his money, and then Vladimir went in there and fucking, like, he shut him out just like he does everybody else. And, so, I mean, he was never impressive to me. I always thought Ibrahimov was the better fighter back when they were both champions at the same time.
As well. Yeah.
So, I mean, it'll be interesting. I mean, heavyweight fights in general are interesting now just because of the way that the division got shaken up recently. So, I mean, that'll just kind of be added to the top of it. And also the fact that, you know, it's for the WBA regular title. I know the WBA is going to be doing that unification shit. Yeah. So, you know, whoever wins will probably be in line to fight against Fury and all that. So,
yeah, like Robertson Castillo, he's the one who beat Ronnie Rios. You know what I'm talking about?
He upset him. He was supposed to lose that fight.
Yeah, I know. He's fighting. He's fighting for the interim WBC Featherweight Championship. So, I guess he's going to be fighting Santa Cruz if he wins this fight. He's going against...
No, you know what? Gary Russell has the WBC. That's the reason why this is for the interim.
Was that?
Gary Russell has the WBC. That's why this one is for the interim.
Yeah, that's right. There you go. Have you mentioned this fight again? Oscar Escondon, yeah?
Yeah. I mentioned it.
Oh, yeah. Man, that Robertson guy is an upset guy. He'd be upsetting loads of people, bro. He'd be upsetting coming down people's hometowns and beating him. They call him Robin Hood, didn't they?
Yeah, well, like Rocky Juarez, too. He beat up on Rocky Juarez.
Yeah, by unanimous decision as well. I like that dude. If anything, I might. If what's his name again? Thing in the chat, Brother E. I might put my money on that one, but I'm not. I don't think I put money on Tony Thompson. I don't think I'll be doing that, bro. But right, no. Anything else?
Let me take a look. See what else on the schedule here. Well, you got fights over there in England, Bradley Skeete.
The
dudes from the coalition that put me on that dude, Bradley Skeete, man. that guy's terrible to watch.
Yeah.
Well, and hey, that dude, Kaya Fai, I know that he's been hyped and everything, him and his brother.
Yeah, his brother's.
Who's the better of the two?
His brother, man, of course. His brother's on a band, though. His brother's band, isn't it?
Oh, bro.
His brother. Are you talking about Kid Gadda and his brother, isn't it? It's Kid Gadda.
No, Kal Yafai and Gamal Yafai.
Oh, yeah. I think the other one, the one he's fighting on Saturday, he's better.
Oh, yeah, Kal's better than Gamal.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, no, because I've seen Kal fight. I've never seen Gamal fight, but I've heard of both of them, so.
Yeah.
Like, I seen Bradley Skeete. I was talking about that fight earlier, who I thought would win, but you're right. Bradley Skeete's a horrible fighter to watch.
Yeah, man. That's. Okay.
It's just not fun.
Yeah, I'm surprised they got him on TV. I guess they think Eggington's gonna knock him out because otherwise, you know, why put him on?
I think Eggington's gonna lose. I picked him to lose because I think he's gonna get spoiled.
Okay.
Talking about this weekend, just because obviously, like, I do watch MMA. Conor McGregor's going against Nate Diaz. I'd like to see that. And Holly Holm's going against Michelle Tate. I like them fights there. I'm going to go with, Connor over Nate, and I'll go with Holly over Michelle Tate. But I don't know if you guys are going to be watching that.
Obviously Connor's going to win. Nate Diaz came in at the last minute because of old boy broke his foot. Dos Anjos.
Rafael De Santos, yeah. Go ahead, Umar. Umar dropped off. Yeah, Rafael De Santos. Umar will probably come back on bracket. What's your take now, Tor, on that? Or you don't
know? Honestly, like, I don't watch MMA like that. Like, I'll catch some of the stuff, like, after the fact and everything. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, I'd say Holm beats Tate, because I'm familiar, at least, with the females, because I've been watching. I don't know. It's kind of funny. I've actually probably seen more female MMA fights than male MMA fights, because, like, back when Gina Carano was the hype, you know, like, I watched a bunch of hers, and then, course, you know, Rousey and all that. Misha Tate, I know she's supposed to be like a really good grappler and everything, but she's not a big girl for that weight class. I know that. I think they brought her up back when they originally first had women fighting in MMA. I think she was at a lower weight class, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, she was. Yeah, you're
right. The reason why, in my opinion, why Tate is hanging around so long is because she's a pretty girl.
She is pretty, you know. She is very attractive, actually.
Yeah, she's a pretty girl. When she does herself up, she's a good-looking girl, so they try to, you know, keep her around. But she doesn't belong in that weight class. She belongs in a weight class. She belongs at 135, not 145.
Yeah.
That's what Nato was saying.
Yeah. But, I mean, Holm should take her out. I mean, Holm, she took pretty much all her skills right over, man. She transitioned them over really beautifully against Rousey and against the previous opponents, so.
Listen, honestly, I like Michelle Tate, but I want Holly Holmes to dominate because I want to see her versus Ronda Rousey. I want to see her finish Ronda Rousey's career.
I don't think Rousey will ever fight her again, Omar.
Well, if she does, you already know what the outcome is.
You know the outcome.
Honestly, I mean, if she's, like, having, like, suicidal thoughts off of that, L, I mean, I don't want to see what it's going to be like after Holm does her again.
Do you guys, let me ask you guys a question. I know EJ does. Now, did you watch ESPN First Take?
Sometimes.
All right, well, did you see when they were talking about Ronda Rousey after she said she wanted to kill herself or whatever?
No, I didn't.
All right, well, I'll just give you a little quick rundown.
It was the saddest bullshit I've ever seen. They were giving her so many passes. Like, they were basically trying to make it seem like Holly Holmes did something wrong by whooping her ass. It was pissing me off.
Of course. That's what they do, man. They had, like, ESPN First Take. That's why I don't watch it that often. Because I don't want to get pissed off and break my fucking TV.
Yeah.
Because those guys are such bums. I remember back when Pacquiao and Marquez were going to run it back. I don't remember if it was the third or the fourth time. They were asking Marquez, like, who would win for between Pacquiao and Mayweather? Basically, like, they were saying, like, oh, after Pacquiao kicks your ass, who do you think that's good enough to beat Mayweather?
That was before the fourth fight, right before Marquez slept this nigga. They were disrespecting Marquez, who's one of my favorite fighters. They weren't even asking Marquez no questions. They were acting like he just didn't mean nothing. He had no chance against Pacquiao. It was so disrespectful. He was a fucking punchback. That's how they treated him. And I was watching that. I was like, yo, you know what? I know my homie Juan Manuel's eating this up right now. This shit's putting the chip on him. I knew it. And I watched that shit. I know exactly what you're talking about. They disrespected that man. Yeah. But that goes to show you, Maji, they don't know nothing about boxing, yet they talk about it. They
Stephen A. Smith is terrible. Stephen A. Smith called Super Cam a coward, bro, because the man didn't want to stay in the press conference. He called Kevin Durant. He goes, you don't want to mess with me. I was like, that's goose, bro.
He challenged fucking Kevin Durant to a fight and shit like
this. Yeah, honestly, I'm surprised one of these athletes haven't fucked up, you know, either of those guys. They're just so damn annoying. Both of them.
Bro, Chris Bosh was this close to knocking out Skip Bayless, because Skip Bayless used to call Chris Bosh Bosh Spice. He was this close to knocking him out. I saw it.
I wish he would have. For real. A lot of those reporters and stuff talk way too much shit for dudes who ain't never probably fucking played a sport in their life.
Yeah. They do that on Cornizer and Wilbur, they be talking the most shit, bro. They talking the most shit on them shows, bro. They literally do is sit behind their TV, sports rise and diss, man. That's what they do. But you know what? Since social media come across with Twitter, bro, them guys are going away. Them guys are going away the dinosaurs, for real, bro.
Yeah, man.
You know, because Stephen A. Smith, man. Bro, it's hard to listen to that dude. The way he went along in the camp. It was sick, man. It made my stomach turn, bro.
Even after Marquez knocked Pacquiao out, then, like, all Skip Bayless could talk about was, oh, that was a lucky punch, and he let Mayweather off the hook, or some stupid shit like that. I'm like, getting me? So that's why when Umar says that, like, oh, that they're making all these excuses for Rousey, it doesn't surprise me. It doesn't surprise me. It's the Pacquiao shit all over again. You know, it's like, oh, like, she probably ate something bad that morning and just making every excuse under the sun for it.
Yeah, well, you can see that guy then. Anything else you guys want to add?
I think we pretty much went through it all.
Umar. Where's Umar? Umar's probably going for a bogey.
Oh shit, Mike Perez versus Martin. Oh, never mind. That's a different Mike Perez. That's fighting this Friday. Oh, that's Michael Perez, the Golden Boy guy. That's fighting on Friday too.
Yeah, in the chat. So Beats is saying to me, I said Nick Blackwell's not that good. Beats disagrees with me because when you talk about EJ, Blackwell's a British champ, and so Nick Blackwell versus Chris Eubank Jr. is going to be coming. You know anything about them two?
Well, I know Eubank. He's a fun fighter to watch. Blackwell, I've only read about him, haven't really watched him. I think it's a good fight. I think Eubank at least is testing himself. You know what I mean? Like, he's one of these guys that he's not just talking a gang of shit and then ducking, you know, the toughest opponents. He's fighting, you know, like fellow prospects, fellow contenders, and, you know, giving it his all. And, I mean, even though he didn't necessarily have, like, a long amateur career, he's going out there and showing and proving in the pros. And, I mean, I tip my hat to Eubank for that.
Before last week, I had the same opinion, but I got to switch my opinion. First of all,
I think that fucking Chris Eubanks is a clown now, because when he released that tape of him knocking out that fucking amateur guy, like, he
made himself fucked up. That was fucked up.
Yeah, he made himself
fucked up. Why was that fucked up?
Because, boxers know, and this is between boxers. I'm not a boxer, but I've been in the gym watching boxers fight, and I've seen boxers get knocked out. Nondescript boxers, mind you. No, nobody famous. I'm not saying I've seen famous people get knocked out. But they don't videotape it, and they don't release it, and they don't speak about it. That's an unwritten rule, and he broke that code, and that was some sucker shit.
Well, not only that, but, you know, it's like just like some amateur kid, you know what I mean? Like, you're going to try and
he's an amateur.
You're going to try and embarrass him for, like, the rest of his life and shit? Like,
hey, man, it is a low blow, man, but I guess that they felt like they was right to do that. When I saw it, I thought nothing covered. I thought, boy, it happens in sparring. I see Deontay Wilder get rocked in sparring by David Haye. Why did David Haye put that out?
That was some sucker shit.
Exactly.
That was some sucker shit. Yeah, I mean, that was definitely some sucker shit from Haye, especially because that was the only clip they showed. You know, he probably could have been getting his ass whooped the whole time.
David Haye released a fucking 15-second clip. He didn't release the whole sparring, and what Nauta just said is probably very apt. He's probably getting his ass whipped the whole fucking time. He landed a shot, and then that's they edited it, and that's the shot they released. Like, that shit is gay.
Yeah, that sounds like something that somebody that's salty would do. Like, you think you're so big and bad? Well, guess what? I rocked you this one time, so I'm going to show everybody
that I did that. That's like if I went to England and me and EJ was sparring, and EJ was whooping my ass the whole time, but in the last fucking 30 seconds of the fight, I catch him with a right hand, he goes down. And all I do is edit that shit, and I put that out there. That makes me look like I was whooping his ass the whole time, but that's not the case. Yeah.
Eubank has embraced the dark side. He wants to be a villain, bro. He don't know bounds about that guy's a villain, bro. He embraced the dark side.
I mean, his dad helps, though, too. Because at least with him, he's playing off of what all the shit that his dad talks. Because I'm like Angel and Danny, for instance. Danny doesn't capitalize enough on that. Like,
you know, as a fighter, I think you need that mean streak as well. I think that's what they're exhibiting.
Oh, you do.
I think you need
that. I'm telling you, the most disappointing in boxing in 2015, well, that was 2016, actually, but most disappointing thing was the Angel Garcia and Robert Guerrero build-up. They waited till the last press conference to go at each other. They should have been going at each other from day one.
Yeah.
And they waited way too long. I mean, the last one, they went at each other, and it was hilarious, but they should have been doing that from the first. As soon as the fight got signed, they should have been talking shit.
Agreed.
Yeah, that's true.
Agreed. No doubt about it, man. Absolutely, boy. But you know how that was it's a PVC one. It wasn't a pay-per-view one. It wasn't on Showtime.
That's
so true. That's why it isn't, you know.
Yeah, to hold back a little bit on all the...
Robert Guerrero's father, Ruben started that shit when he said Angel can't speak no Spanish, and Angel came back and started speaking Spanish and talking greasy. That shit had me dying. They waited too long, man. They should have started that earlier.
Hey, man, that's what it is, man. Boy, I'm draining out over in the UK. Actually, let me give it real quick, because I haven't seen it. What's your guys' take on Adrian Broner and Ashley Fairfield press conference and Mayweather, you know, going in on Adrian Broner? Because I haven't seen the press conference fully. What's your guys' take on that?
Honestly, I never really believed all that friendship stuff between Mayweather and Broner. To me, back when that whole, you know, relationship, I guess you might call it, that whole friendship first started, to me, Mayweather was basically like, it's almost like the pretty chick with her ugly friend or with her fat friend or whatever.
Yeah.
Like they look better by comparison. And I think Mayweather did that for that reason. He was using Adrian Broner for that reason, even before Broner had lost. Because I think Floyd even knew that shit was coming. He knew it was coming. And then when it came a crop against Madonna, you know, that just proved him correct. And you know, from then on, I think, you know, Mayweather, I remember he released a couple of different tweets or whatever, kind of clowning Broner, too, saying, like, oh, he shouldn't have been doing all that partying and all that other stuff. You know, he was talking a bunch of shit. So, I mean, of course, Broner's going to get pissed about that because, you know, Broner, to me, like, I don't know, he doesn't seem like the sharpest knife in the tool shed, you know, the sharpest knife in the drawer. Like, he doesn't seem to have, like, the greatest social graces. Like, he's not... like socially intelligent, I guess you might say. He's not the most natural kind of talker and everything. Everything seems real put upon. He seems like a quiet, you know, shy type of guy that just kind of acts up for the attention. And so just the fact that he thought the friendship was legit, and it turned, but, you know, it turned out he realized that it wasn't, you know, he was being bullshitted the whole time. I think he's real bitter about that. And so that's led him to being a little bit more harsh with all the TMT guys in general, too. And then and also the fact that, like, Mayweather had promoted that fight with him and John Molina. And then, like, after that, that was like a one and done. And then, you know, they didn't have nothing to do with each other after that. So I think all that kind of plays into it.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of agree with Nauta. The only thing I really want to speak on that is that I watched the video, and I'm not going to mention the guy's name, but the guy needs to stop fucking making up fucking tags for his videos just to get views saying certain things happen. Because I watched the guy's video, right? And I was expecting Broner to say what he said in the video. The video said, Broner says, fuck Mayweather. And Broner never said that. And that shit pisses me off when people do that in their videos. And that's all I want to say. But Broner said what he had to say. What do you expect him to say? Fucking Floyd is defending Treasure Theophane because that's his fighter, and that's what it is, and that's what he's gonna do. And Broner saying, you know, all right, well, right now we can't be friends. We gotta be enemies because I'm fighting your fighter. So what was really said that was controversial? I didn't really understand it, but what Nauta said, I agree that their friendship is kind of fucking surface. It's a surface friendship. It ain't real. It's just something that they do for, you know, for the benefit of both of them, for each other. Then I don't think those dudes is really sitting in the crib, you know, playing Madden together. You know, eating chicken wings and watching sports. I just don't see that. It's not that type of friendship.
Do you feel if anything, I think Broner probably benefits more from it than Floyd does.
Do you feel that? Hey, you think Ash the Fear of Fame should be getting the title shot on the rules?
No. Why not? He says, nah. I mean, nah is as far as earning it, but why not? I mean, a lot of guys get title shots these days and days. Why not Ashley? Ashley's got over 40 fights. He fought Danny Garcia. He fought fucking, who'd he fight? Nate Campbell. He fought a lot of fucking guys. Give the guy a title shot. Whether he wins or loses, just give him one. He's, you know, I don't care. It don't bother me.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not the worst challenger, but
and a lot of people, and if you watch that Danny Garcia fight, a lot of people think Ashley won that fight. So, whether he wins or loses, give him one, and if he loses, then you know he got a nice payday. He can go back to England, buy himself a cottage, and you know do his thing. And he looked clean to the motherfucker with them glasses and that suit on. So it's all good. Good for Treasure.
Yeah, honestly, like, really, this is probably just Floyd getting his homie paid, really. You know, he probably hasn't really made that much through his career. So this will probably be a nice chunk of change for him.
Exactly. He'll get probably about $2 million to fight Adrian, and Floyd is just looking out for his homie, man. The guy that helped him get ready for a lot of fights, just like he did for fucking old boy that said he wanted to kill himself. I can't remember his name right now, but you don't know what I'm talking about.
Wait a minute, is this a PBC fight or is it on Showtime?
Showtime.
Okay.
Matter of fact, no, that's PBC. It's PBC.
Okay, I was just wondering because I was curious. I was thinking about, you know, hypothetically what the purse is going to be.
Well, that's that, man. Well, anything else? Well, we've got some good fights coming up. Everyone's kind of made their predictions on who we want. Got people in the chat commenting and stuff like that. So, hey, EJ's Tuesday night prediction is looks like it's at a wrap. Who we got in there? Floyd is really looking out for Broner. We're setting up the scrap with Ashley Fearing because Broner has nowhere to go at 147 and he gets stopped by the top at 140. I don't know, maybe. That's Brother E in the chat. Commenting. I don't know, man. Broner's got fear bases. Go Crawford fight. I want to see Crawford versus Broner, to be honest with you.
I
would love to see it, but the fight will never happen.
Nah, it's got a possibility to happen. Broner will fight him. I think that's a good possibility happening.
Nah, it's Bob Arum, Al Heyman. The fight ain't going to happen.
Crawford, man. Rob Aaron, look, man. I'm sure that fight will happen. Look, you said Mayweather and Pacquiao will never happen.
There's nothing that
can't. That's different. That's different. There was a lot of money at stake.
Yeah.
There's enough money in it. The fight will happen. So nothing. I'll never say nothing against nothing no more. People thought my ties to Lent Lewis and Avon because they were in different rivalry companies happened. So there's nothing, you know.
It's got to be a lot of money. It's got to be a lot of money built.
I think Crawford's doing what he's doing. Crawford one more fight. Adrian Broner looks two more defenses. They look good. They'll match up. Adrian Broner won it. The public demanded it. These two brothers, they should have met out lightweight.
Oh, Adrian's getting beat up. If that dumb fight does happen, Adrian's getting beat up.
I tell you, Adrian, I would have preferred Adrian at lightweight to fight that.
Honestly, though, like the greatest thing about that fight to me would be the crowd, man. Especially like depending on where they hold it, because I'm sure they probably want like neutral ground. Maybe they put it in Texas or something. Man, like just think of how the crowd would be. You know, it would be
Texas. You don't know, Broner, Adrian Broner has power at 140 and 135, bro. He had power at 135 and 140. He hits harder, brother. Don't hit no 147, he's not no power. But at 140, at 135, Adrian Broner had power, bro. Trust me.
Yeah, 147 is power didn't translate, man, because
Well, I mean, he still has a little bit. It's like that snapping power. It doesn't have the lasting effect, though. It's not that power that you take with you, where you hit a guy and like they feel it like the next round. Still, it's just the power that like it affects you in that moment.
Yeah. So, but the postal fight. I think 140 has. There's some real good fights out there. Listen, Postal needs to be more active than he is, man. He had a big win against Matisse. You need to be back out. That's the thing about some of these fights.
That's Bob Arum's fault.
Nah, I understand. No, not really. Like, but Gary Russell Jr., like, one fight against Johnny Gonzalez, you know, you lose against Feng, you disappear. You know what I'm going to say? This is what bothers me about boxing. What used to piss me off about that guy. What's that guy? He was a guy from the Dominican Republic, the one who got beat up. They used to call him the Little Tyson. Yeah, what? Juan Guzman was a fucking badass, bro. Juan Guzman, he was a little fucking bad man, yeah. He just didn't fight active, dude. And that's what happens to some of these fighters. They just turn inactive and just disappear. Gary Russell Jr. and look, Andre Ward, you know, that's why he's opened himself to all this criticism, because he's not active. And some of the guys he fights, I still believe Andre Ward is number one pound for pound. But, bruv, like, you just need to be more active, and it's frustrating. It's very frustrating to see when we had back in the days when these fights, like, when you see Mike Tyson used to fight like, once a month, two a month, twice a month, some of these guys, yeah, it really pisses you off, and there's no reason why. You know, you couldn't be at Crawford. That's why people are liking Crawford, because there's some familiarity with him. He fights quite regularly, and against good opposition, he's been doing it looking good. So, I quote, you know, Crawford is crawling up the pound-for-pound rankings real quick for me, man. That was a good stop against Lundy. So, you know,
That's like I mentioned earlier. That's why I like that doing the Nayo thing, because I mean he regularly fights like four times a year. You never see champions fight that often.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, him or like I remember Edgar Sosa years ago back when he was in his prime. He defended his title I think five times in a year.
Yeah.
And like to me that was enough for him to get Fighter of the Year for me that year. I think it was like 2009 if I remember right. You know, it's really a shame that guys don't fight more often. And see, and the thing is, I don't even care necessarily if some of those fights aren't the best of opponents. Because, I mean, it's like you look back on some of the old school fighters, the throwbacks or whatever, and they have plenty of guys that weren't on their level, you know, that they were fighting. But it was just, you know, to keep themselves busy, you know, earn a little extra side money, you know, keep their names out there. And, I mean, it really helped them overall because, one, it helped them stay sharp. It helped them keep their name out there. And it, you know, they might not have been getting paid the top dollar for those fights, but they were still getting paid enough, and they were keeping their names out in the public to such a degree that they could still demand the top dollar for
them. I mean, that's why people like Chocolito in Sasam, which is the man busy, he's constantly fighting, constantly out there, he's constantly fighting, Kovalev, Triple G, they're constantly fighting, they're constantly...
Yeah, Kovalev's been real active, that's one thing you can say for
him. He's been active, innit?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying, and... Being active and this keeps people out there, you know. So that's
kind of getting knocked out because Mirkan fights once a year for like the past 3 years. He's getting knocked out.
Amir's gonna beat fucking Canelo, bro. I told you.
Okay.
I gotta admit, even though I've never really been high in the fight, when they actually get in the ring and are standing across from each other, I'm probably going to be pretty hyped to see it, just because, I don't know, like, it's such a weird fight, you know what I mean? It's like if you hit the random select on a video game or some shit. Like, oh shit, Amir Khan versus Canelo, oh, all right, you know?
It's like Fight Night when you do the one mode where you can fight any weight class against any weight class. That's what it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Forgot the name of that shit, but that's going to happen. And Amir Khan's going to get slept.
Yeah, whatever. Laughing it. But you know what? We're going to find out in a couple of days. Well, fight fans, we'll call it a day, man. I enjoyed this conversation. I was expecting more people over. Scorsese came over. We had Gus from the Boxing Voice. He had his little take. We have Ben Umar, the Boxing Terrorist. We have Nalta TV. Noah's got his channel. Check that out. And we've made our predictions, man. Whether they come true, we know in a couple of days. But what I will do is that after the Tony Thompson fight against Luis Ortiz, I will do straight after. I will do a hangout straight after. Hopefully, I'll do. If it's not too late in the morning, I'll do one. And also, on the same card, Julia Williams versus that guy, then that should be good as well. So I'll do a hangout straight after and see how it is, man. But try and keep these things going, man. But I appreciate you guys coming over. Anything else you guys want to say to the people listening? Nalta and Umar?
No, I mean, just watch the fights, man. Try to catch as many as you can, because I know there's a lot of them. You know, there's going
to
be a lot.
Yeah, I'm good, man. Just shout out to Sadam Ali, man. Williamsburg, Brooklyn, the building.
Cool, man. All right. So from EJ Boxing Live, Nalta, Scorsese, Gus, Ben Umar, we'll catch you on the next one. Peace.